B'shem Hashem na'aseh v'natzliach, shiur Torah. Thank you for coming, Baruch Hashem. Good to see new faces, old faces, and Baruch Hashem, we have some new people online that are listening to the shiur, Baruch Hashem. Also, thank you to Torah Anytime for continuing to publicize our shiurim, Yishtabach Shemo, since they put us online. There's been a lot of new fans, Baruch Hashem, and now, in the last month or so, they've had our personal story featured on the front page. And Baruch Hashem, a lot of people are motivated by it from across the world, you know, from different parts of it. And as I said, some people because of health issues, some people because of money issues, just some people because of purely because of tshuva. And, you know, you're getting emails, and it's really inspiring to me, I think probably even more to them, that someone will take, you know, a couple of hours of their personal time and listen to my shiur Torah. It's, to me, it's unbelievable. So, Baruch Hashem, you know, Hashem is continuing to give us strength, and Be'ezrat Hashem will continue to publicize His Torah. So this week's Parashat Ki Tavo, is one of the parashat we mentioned several times throughout the year as the most difficult parasha in the entire Torah, in a sense of not difficult to read. They're all, I would say, for better or for worse, the same, but rather the most difficult to hear. Because there are two parashot that are considered, that are called the parashot of the ochacha, of the rebuke. In the Torah, parashat Ki Tavo is one of them, and parashat Bechukotai is the other one, in the book of Leviticus. And both of these parashot give us Hashem's perspective of how He runs the world in a very, very black and white system. A lot of people in our generation like gray, but Hashem is telling you in these parashot, there is no such thing as gray. There is no such thing as half religious. There is no such thing as modern orthodox. There is no such thing as I'll just keep whatever mitzvot I like. It's either yes or it's no. For the ones that is yes, you'll get reward. For the one that you don't do, you'll get punished. It's as simple as it gets. And this is one of the things that I think we fail to understand in our generation, where we're constantly putting words in Hashem's mouth and saying, oh no, Hashem will understand me. Where did He say I'm going to understand you in the Torah? You have 24 books, 5 books of Moses and 19 other books. Where, give me one verse that He says, if you do whatever you want, I'll understand you. Where does it say that? What book was ever written in history by an Orthodox rabbi? You know, because if it's Reform or Conservative, then you might as well talk about giving bar mitzvahs to dogs. So that, you can't really use them. So you have to talk about, you know, something that complies with the Torah. Where in history has anyone that was an Orthodox Jew, whether standard level or sage level, did anybody ever write, if you do whatever you want, Hashem will understand you. It's okay. It's quite the contrary. If you look at Parashat Bechukotai, Hashem, every time He gave us each description of the curses, there are 5 levels of curses, 5 levels of punishment, if we don't follow His rules, He started it with the same thing. He said, V'alachtem imi bekeri. If you didn't do tshuva, and you went with me with casualness. Casualness. Meaning that if you didn't do tshuva, meaning you continued sinning, but on top of not doing tshuva, you made another sin. What is it? Treating my Torah like it's casual, like you could do whatever you want. I'll keep this one. No, this one doesn't fit. This one is good. This one is easy. Oh, I like this one. This one is good for the family. That one, no, no, it's too difficult. I'm not going to do it. If you did that, you just pick and choose whatever you feel like doing. He says, just for obviously not doing tshuva, you get punished. He tells you the punishment. But v'alachti mibikeri, meaning you treated me with casualness, is a separate level of punishment. It's an additional punishment. There's a punishment for violating Shabbat, violating Talak Mishpacha, violating, you know, business laws, all types of things. But then there's a completely separate level of punishment for treating Hashem like He's one of your buddies from the bar. Saying, I could say hello if I feel like it. Or I don't feel like calling Him today. This is what He says. So this is what he, so he, In essence, Hashem in his Torah said the opposite of what today's opinion is. So the reason why Hashem spent nearly half of this Torah telling us the details of his mitzvot and the details of if we don't listen to him is to make sure that we know that what to do. But the reason why he specifically wrote in this parasha, Parashat Ki Tavo, the details of what happens if we don't listen, but the details, not just one off here, one off there, like in many other parashot, but an entire parasha about what happens if we don't listen to mitzvot, is in order to eliminate the common opinion that will one day arrive 3,300 years after we receive the Torah, that says, maybe there's not just a black and white system, maybe there's a gray. And today's generation with gay parades every other day, maybe there's a pink too. So, or rainbow, right. By the way, do you guys ever think about the whole thing, about the whole rainbow thing? Just, I mean, it's off subject. It's off subject, but anybody here ever think, I've mentioned it in a shiur a long time ago, for anybody who never actually look at how Hashem gives us his signature in everything and tells us his feelings in everything. So I'll give you an understanding. So the gay parade and gay pride and the whole promotion of homosexuality, which is specifically discussed in the Torah many times as something that Hashem considers disgusting. To'avat Hashem. To'ava means disgusting. Okay? And Hashem puts it, every time homosexuality is mentioned in the Torah, you will notice that in, I think in every case, but at the very least, in most cases, it's mentioned right next to bestiality, as we've mentioned before, because to Hashem, a man with a man is the same thing as a man with an animal, or a woman with an animal. Same thing to him. This one's not appropriate, that one's not appropriate. This one's disgusting to him, that one's disgusting to him. Simple as it gets. It doesn't necessarily mean that you can go out there and start killing homosexual people, but the key is, just like Bulia told Rabbi Meir, you can't hate the sinners. You hate the sins. Hate the sins and pray for them to do tshuva. But to say it's okay, say chazaku baruch, celebrate them. Oh, Baruch Hashem, you came out of the closet. That's not helping anyone. That's enabling them. So you have to tell them what the Torah says. Now, in case anyone is confused, Hashem gave you a sign within their own sign. So they celebrate their gay parade, unfortunately, in Jerusalem, in Tel Aviv, in New York, and pretty much all over the world. And their flag is the rainbow. Now, what was the first time we heard about the rainbow?
After
Noah's flood. What happened in Noah's flood? What was it, a flood? Just like, you know, I had a flood one time in my parents' basement? No, it wasn't like that, right? It was a different type of flood. That flood didn't just destroy a basement. It destroyed the entire world. It was a type of flood that came from above and came from below. According to the Gemara, Hashem moved one of the stars, which we find out later on is a comet. So it's a big, giant piece of ice, out of place and flooded the earth from on top. But on the bottom came boiling water and lava. So anything from above and beyond, everything was destroyed, with the exception, obviously, Hashem let Noah and his family and Og, Melech HaBashan, Og, the giant, survive. And the animals, of course, or at least most of them. But after the flood, we hear that Hashem gave Noah a brit, a sign, which was the rainbow. And Hashem tells Noah, this is the sign as a memory that I will not destroy the world. Okay, that's it. That's what we got. But Chazal tells us, what does it mean Hashem is giving us a sign? He's not going to destroy the world. What does it mean? Okay, so if it's really simply, I'm just in a sign, I'm not going to destroy the world, show it to us once and that's it. One time you have a rainbow and that's it. Why are you showing it to us every other day when it rains, especially here in Boca Raton, where it seems like there is the flood here. Every day it rains. Since I moved here, I think this half the year is rain. It rains every day. It's unbelievable. Bukhaba. It rains all the time. Rain today, rain yesterday, the day before. It rains every day. I'm always waiting to see maybe Noah's going to show up one day. But anyway, If it was really just a one-time sign, okay, guys, I'm not going to destroy the world, then Hashem would show it to us one time, show it to Noach, and that's it. We would never see it again. If it was simply a sign that he's not going to destroy the world, what is it really? Every time you see a rainbow, Chazal tells us you're not allowed to stare at it, point at it, and tell people, hey, hey, look, 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 look. You're not allowed to do that. Why? Because in essence, what you're doing is you're mocking Hashem. How are you mocking Hashem? Hashem is telling you right now, right this second, that you see the rainbow, I'm angry enough at the actions, at the sins of mankind, that if it wasn't for the deal of me and Noach, I would destroy the world right now. If it wasn't for the deal that I signed over 4,000 years ago with Noach, Ish Tzadik V'Tamim, a righteous person that's complete, if it wasn't for the deal that I signed with him, right now I would destroy the world. Right now, you don't, right this second, you don't have enough merits to exist. That's why I show you the rainbow. To remind you, you better start doing tshuva. Go do a mitzvah right now. Put the world at 50%. So we're not at 49% anymore. Go do a mitzvah. So you tell him, when you point at the rainbow, say, hey, look, look, what a beautiful rainbow. Look, this is so nice. In essence, what you're saying is, look, look, Hashem wants to destroy the world. Ha-ha. And he can't because he made a deal. Not allowed to do that. Not allowed to do that. So if you see a rainbow, you do a blessing, but that's it. You can't stare at it, tell people to look at it. So in essence, how does this connect to this whole gay situation? All right, maybe a more politically correct word is homosexuality, I guess. Is that they have a flag. They have a flag, which is the colors of the rainbow. But in essence, one of the biggest sins that led Hashem to destroy the world, what was the final sin? We did a whole 3.5 hour shiur about it. What was it? Wasting seed. Wasting seed, but not just regular wasting seed. Wasting seed through homosexuality to such an extent that they even affected the animals, where animals became intimate with different species. The zebra with the pig with the lion. It was a complete tohu wabohu. Hashem says, this is not what I created the world for. You're wasting seed, you're being homosexual, this is not for me, this is disgusting to me. Hashem destroyed the world. So these homosexuals don't realize that they're waving this flag around, celebrating this rainbow. In reality, what they're saying to Hashem, look, Hashem, we're the reason you destroyed the world. We're still around. And this is why you see a lot of the punishments in the world, you know, happen to areas that have such a thing. Just a few days ago, we had a bombing in New York. It's not exactly the most kosher area in America. You know, I lived not too far from there. Trust me, I know what's there. The reality of it is that you have a lot of issues. And also, one of the things that we learn throughout this parasha is that Hashem says that one of the punishments that He's going to give us if we don't follow His laws, which also mean the laws of sexuality, He's going to bring us different types of diseases, and He specifically says, I'm going to bring you the diseases of Egypt, and even the diseases that are not mentioned in this book of Torah. Even the ones that are not mentioned in this Torah, I'm going to bring you. Now, AIDS didn't come from a Orthodox Haredi family. Didn't come from there. Didn't come from a modest woman and a modest man. You understand? So, I think it's very, very important to remind ourselves every single year, at least, more than a couple of times, to review these parashot in real detail, especially Parashat Bechukotai and Ki Tavo, because anytime we have a hard time connecting to Hashem, we start thinking that He's like one of our buddies, and we could just pick and choose whatever we want. We have a little bit of doubt. Fine. Read the parasha with commentary, basic commentary by Rashi. You want to read even more. You want to read Me'am Loez. You want to read some Gemara. You want to read all types of other sources, by all means. But even the very basic literal translation. of the parasha should give you enough yirat shamayim to stay away from all sins. And this is really the reason why Hashem actually put these parashot in our Torah. Because it's necessary for you to fear Him in order for you to avoid sin. Now, if we don't fear Him, problems arise. Now, in the beginning of this parasha, where it doesn't go straight into the curses or punishments, it actually talks about the whole aspect of different ways of serving Hashem. But before I get into it, you had a question. You had a question, huh?
I read somewhere that you're actually supposed to point it out to remind people to repent, the rainbow.
Point out that there was one, but not point it out when it's out there, when it's in the sky, no.
Someone sees a rainbow, you're not supposed to point
it. Not supposed to point at a rainbow and tell people to look at it.
Some people take pictures in front of a rainbow. Some people take pictures in front of rainbows.
Yes, listen, before you... Someone that doesn't know Torah, how are they going to know you're not allowed to do it? They think it's nice. It is beautiful. I mean, the rainbow is a very, very beautiful creation. Like every other creation that Hashem made. It's amazing. It's completely against all logic. That all these wonderful colors would be, you know, constantly the same thing. It's different places. It's amazing. So yes, it's beautiful, but it means something. Like everything else in the world, it means something. And Hashem is telling us it means that He's upset enough at us that He would destroy the world had it not been for the deal that He made with Noah. Any other question?
But shouldn't that show a sign of like repentance? Don't do it type thing?
Yeah, that's the point. He puts it there in the sky because he knows that people are going to look up. Because naturally, you know, your inclination is to look. If let's say, for example, you're walking in the middle of the street, and someone was within a direct line of vision from you, let's say, you know, from second story of a building, waving out of a window, naturally your human instinct would be to look at him, waving. Even if you don't know that he's there, your natural human instinct will direct you in that direction, you'll see him waving. So because there's something new, that's in the environment. So the same thing with the rainbow or anything else in the sky. Every time you hear something that's above you, you always naturally, your instinct is to look up. So when there's a rainbow, your instinct is to look up. Hashem specifically put it up there for you to look at it and repent. But He didn't want you to make a party out of it and tell the whole neighborhood, hey, come look how beautiful this is. Because it's not about the beauty. It's about a sign for us to do tshuva. A sign for us to realize that each one of us has to take it upon ourselves to go do the next mitzvah as soon as possible and get this world above 50%.
What's this thing I've been hearing about Planet X? Like, this rabbi made a video about it and it got me very nervous.
Planet X is...
It's true.
I mean, from what it looks like based on science, it is true, yes. I mean, there's enough evidence about it that it is true. I mean, people see it. I mean, there's videos of it. It's true. It's actually also mentioned in the Zohar. It's mentioned by the prophets. Whether what they say is going to happen or not, meaning that it's going to, you know,
destroy the world
or not, that's only in the hands of Hashem.
Except two-thirds of the people would die from hunger.
Yeah, I mean, there's plenty of prophecies about the end of times. Right now we're seeing so many of them come true that you have to be blind, deaf, and stupid to not think that it's the end of times. Whether it's the Planet X, which it says it's going to be a possibility of how Hashem may punish the world before the Mashiach comes. And again, there's plenty of evidence that it's true as far as that it exists. Whether the outcome is that it's going to, you know, run into the world or get close enough to our atmosphere that either way, it doesn't have to, you know, collide with the world. It's still going to change the gravitational pull to such an extent that it's going to create tsunamis and all type of havoc in the world. Whether that happens or not, I don't care. To me, it doesn't really make a difference, and it shouldn't matter to you. Why? Because either way, we have to do tshuva. Either way, the job that you have individually stays the same. You have to do tshuva, and you have to influence other people to do tshuva. So whether it's Planet X, or it's going to be the War of Gog and Magog, or it's going to be, there's also a prophecy about an earthquake. There's several different prophecies of what could happen at the end of times. The way it looks right now is that Hashem is making us, anyone that's searching for it, will see that all possibilities have become likely. All of them. Not one. You know, if you just say, listen, the world's heating up, it's a possible war, look what's happening between Russia and the US, Russia and Syria. You know, they brought over 200 atomic bombs to fight ISIS, they say, and obviously no one with a brain believes that they're actually fighting ISIS with atomic bombs, because not only does ISIS not care about atomic bombs, but you don't need 200 atomic bombs to fight them. Obviously you realize that's nonsense. You see that there's a fight brewing between the world powers. So you see option one, if you say, oh, listen, it's only a war, some people say, no, this has always been happening, but because of the media today, you know it. So you can rationalize that this is just regular human nature. It's normal. It's no big deal. Don't get so worked up about Russia. Let me go invest some more money into Google and Microsoft. You know, let me build my portfolio for another few million dollars, because what do I care about a war? So you can easily rationalize that the war that's actually happening, the Third World War that already started in September of last year, it already started. It's just quiet. Started. The war already started. It's just quiet. Meaning the war is very small now. Same thing how World War II started. Same thing how World War I started. Same thing how every war started. It wasn't like one day everybody just started fighting. It started as a small fight, like a street fight. The next thing you know, it's two communities fighting. And next thing you know, it's two countries. And after that, the whole world. So this is, in essence, the same type of thing that's happening. Now the fight between the U.S. and Russia is not a fight with weapons, it's a fight with words. But the words are getting stronger and stronger, and they're also positioning their armies in critical places for, you know, getting ready for an attack. You see the recent moves, if you follow any of this stuff, you see the recent moves that that the United States have made. It's clearly showing they're preparing for, you know, some type of, they say defense, but in reality it's attack. You know, you see the moves that Russia has been making. You know, first they brought in a ship with 200 atomic bombs to Syria. And if that wasn't enough, just a couple of months later, or a little more than a couple of months later, they brought a submarine with even more atomic bombs to the same place. The 200 atomic bombs wasn't enough, they brought even more. So you see, obviously, there's a lot of stuff happening here. But if you don't like to believe that there's going to be a war, because it will disturb your stock portfolio, it will disturb your nice lifestyle, it will disturb your next vacation that you're planning to go to Cancun or something like that, then obviously you don't want to believe in war. So you're going to rationalize it and say, no, it's not happening. This is just politics. Okay, fine. So Hashem says, okay, if that's not enough, I'm going to give you, all of a sudden there's going to be a new planet added to the atmosphere, added to the where we are, to our atmosphere,
been
I guess.
For 50 years, I heard. That's another
it's been around for 50 years, yeah, but
only
now
Russian TV mentioned it.
Of course, there's a lot of things that exist we don't know that they exist. You know, just like the Navi said, the prophet said, you know, to when his helper came to him, Elisha and Navi came, and he says, look, this army is surrounding us. This army of the enemy is surrounding us. He says to them, you have nothing to worry about. We're more than them. We're greater than them. Me and you are greater than them. So he prayed to Hashem and he says, make him see what I see. Please, Hashem, make him see what I see. And he goes outside and he sees all of a sudden the same place, the same mountain area, same army surrounding them, but on top of the mountain are millions and millions of angels with weapons of destruction, outnumbering the enemy millions to one. He sees what's always been there. He just wasn't able to see it. So, the point is, there's a lot of things that are there where we don't see. Like, for example, the Gemara says, every time someone makes a mitzvah, they create an angel. Every time they make a sin, they create a demon. Anyone see any demons next to them? I'm sure you made sins. We're not all tzaddikim. Okay, well, the Gemara also says that if you actually saw all the angels and the demons that are next to you, you wouldn't be able to survive for a moment. You'd go crazy.
Yeah, the cats and dogs can see.
Right. Right. They can see some, not all, but yes, yes. So the point is, that's why you see them sometimes barking or meowing at the wall. Point is that there's a lot of things that are there that Hashem makes sure that we don't see because we're not ready or prepared to see. But this planet has been there for the last 50 years, and no one told us about it, no one saw it, no one wanted to see it. The point is, Hashem made sure that you're seeing it now. You're seeing it live now. Uses pictures of it right now, like with, you know, there's videos of this. There's like one video that I saw once that somebody took where it's like literally looks like there's two suns. It's unbelievable. So it's not like some conspiracy theory, it's really there, it's on the news and so on. So Hashem made sure that right now, end of days, you're going to see it. If that's not enough, right? So if that's not enough, you have the earthquake prophecy. And if you look at all of the things that are happening in the world, whether you want to talk about global warming, or you're talking about all types of weird things that are happening around the world, there's strange earthquakes happening, and there's also different sinkholes. Sinkholes happening in different parts of the world. Now, a sinkhole is pretty much 1 minute you're here, the next minute there's a hole the size of a small town. And it just goes straight to the bottom of the earth.
Happened before.
What happens? It's happening every day.
Where?
Everywhere. It's happening every single day. There's people that actually track this stuff. It's actually happening at Yam HaMelech. The Dead Sea, it's happening. It's been happening already for several years at the Dead Sea. It's happening all over the United States. It's happening all over the world. In Russia, there's plenty of places. Huge, huge sinkholes in the middle. Just all of a sudden, you have a hole. And it's mamash, something that it would take years to create that type of hole. Just like that, you have a hole in the middle of the world. Middle of the world. So you're seeing that the ground is shaking. There's places that never had an earthquake in their history. All of a sudden have earthquakes. The world is changing. People want to blame it, if the ones, the rationalists, want to blame it on different types of digging that they're doing for gas. You know, they're digging different, you know, digging into rocks. They're getting gas out of rocks. So they're blaming that. They're blaming oil companies. They're blaming, I don't know, blaming aliens. They're blaming whatever they want. Everything except God. Everything except God. So, like I said, for anyone that has even 1% Yirat Shamayim, it's very easy to see that Hashem is making sure that all of the prophecies of the end of times are very obvious to us. For anyone who doesn't have Yirat Shamayim, you could rationalize every one of these things that I just said and pretty much say that, no, this guy's crazy. He should stick to his Torah and avoid science and politics. I'm fine, you can do that too. So we go back to Torah. Even though this was also Torah, but the point is that it's a, you know, it's either you believe or you don't believe. I think the most important point out of all of it is to know that regardless of which one of the prophecies comes true, all of us still have the same job today. All of us have to do tshuva, whether you are frum from birth, or you are baal tshuva, or you're a recent convert, or you're a convert in the making. Whatever it is, you must repent. You must do tshuva. You must talk to Hashem on a daily basis. It's one of the 613 mitzvot that Am Yisrael has, is to repent every day. Do vidui. Every day say, Chatati, Aviti, Pashati. Hashem, I sinned accidentally. I sinned intentionally, knowingly at least. And I sinned intentionally to make you angry. And yes, this happens. People get angry at Hashem, they make sins on purpose. Bezat Hashem, none of you are in that position, at least not on a regular basis. But I can tell you for sure that at some point people have done, everybody has done it. Nonetheless, each one of us has to repent for all those sins because we don't know which ones He forgave us for already. We don't know which ones we've actually repented for completely. we don't even know all the sins we made. And we don't even know all the sins that we're making, because we don't know all of the mitzvot yet. We're just doing tshuva. Even if you're frum for birth, doesn't mean you remember the entire Shulchan Aruch by heart. So you have to repent every day. A righteous Jew repents every single day. And this is in the Gemara. Say, the sage tells his students, a righteous person needs to do tshuva the day before he dies. So the students go, Rabbeinu, how does somebody know when they're going to die? He says, that's the point. Since you don't know when you're going to die, you better do it every day. You better repent every day. One of the 613 mitzvot is to do vidui. Say chatati aviti pashati, repent to Hashem. I'm sorry I did this, I'm sorry I did that. Start thinking about your sins.
And say, I'm going to repent on it later. People say, I won't keep Shabbat, but I'll repent. Or I'll go with the goyim.
That makes you a complete rasha merusha. That's like
you cannot
makes it a the worst type of sin. Someone says, I'm going to sin now and say I'm sorry later, that person has a special penthouse in Gehinnom. That's not good.
And they will
let him do tshuva. Right, so now saying I'm gonna sin and then I'm gonna do tshuva, the Chazal specifically has a memoir on it, like you just said, that they won't, you will never arrive at the time to be able to do tshuva. So you're not allowed to do such a thing. But nonetheless, the point is that we all have to do tshuva every single day. That's the first thing. Last thing is that we have to make other people do tshuva. Any way that you possibly can, whether it's to give lectures, give CDs out, post things on the internet if you already are on the internet. If you're not on the internet, then don't get on it. Find another way, give CDs out, arrange lectures. Get people back to Hashem. You must do Kiruv. Just like Chazal told us, two things are going to save us at the end of days. Torah v'gmilut chasadim. And as we mentioned in many lectures, Torah means to learn it and to follow it. Learning it by itself means zilch. You have to learn it and follow it. And the second thing is gemilut chasadim, which is overwhelming kindness. Overwhelming kindness, Chazal tells us, the highest level of kindness is not just giving someone a ride to the store. Highest level of kindness, overwhelming kindness, means to bring him back to Hashem. The highest level of kindness. Every single Jew has some type of relative, friend, family, acquaintance, somebody that they're connected to that's off the derech. It could be the biggest, from family. It could be the average people. Everyone knows somebody. Even some big rabbanim, unfortunately, have family that, you know, that's off the derech. You know, and I'm not just saying this. I mean, this is known information. So everyone has to do Kiruv in one way or another. And again, you start with things at home, you start with your neighborhood, you start with your community. And if you have saved everyone around you, then start saving people everywhere else. Either way, you have to do something. So those are the couple of things that we all have to do every single day. Baruch Hashem, you know, this is something that we've encouraged a lot of people to do, and they're doing it, but there's still a lot of work to be done. If each one of us takes on, you know, just one person, I'm not telling you take 50 people, like one person, entire Am Yisrael takes, you know, the frum community, people that keep Shabbat, each person takes one person. So let's say we have 3 million religious in Am Yisrael, let's say. Now, within the next year, you have 6 million. Within 2 years, you have 12 million. 3 years, everybody does tshuva. That's it, Zat Hashem. So that's the beauty of it. Is you don't have to take on the whole world. If you can, do. But point is, it doesn't take much other than a little bit of love for Hashem. A little bit. Not that much. A little bit of love for Hashem. All of Am Yisrael will do tshuva b'ezrat Hashem. So, first thing that Hashem tells us in this parasha, V'aya ki tavo el haaretz asher Adonai Elohecha noten lecha, nachala v'yishta v'yashavta ba. ולקחת מראשית כל פרי האדמה אשר תביא מארציך אשר אדוני אלוהיך נותן לך ושמת בתנה והלכת אל המקום אשר יבחר אדוני אלוהיך לשכן שמו שם. Translation. It will be when you enter the land that Hashem your God gives you as an inheritance, and you possess it and dwell in it, that you shall take of the first of every fruit of the ground that you bring in from your land that Hashem your God gives you. And you shall put in a basket and go to the place that Hashem your God will choose to make his name rest there. So here, Hashem is telling us that when we're going to do anything for him, we have to make sure we have some kavanah. He says, when you're going to bring your ma'aseh, the tithe, to me, don't be like a Kain. Don't be like Kain and give me the worst of your produce, the worst of your cotton, the worst of your wheat, the worst of any of the goods that you have. Bring me the reshit, bring me the best. Why bring me the best? Hashem really needs this? Hashem needs your apples? Hashem needs your cow? Hashem needs your anything? It's his anyway. Liya kesef liya za'av ne'um Hashem tzevaot. So Hashem says, Prophet tells us, Hashem is telling us, everything is his. His is the silver, his is the gold. So what does he need? What does he care if it's the first one, it's the last one? What does he care, Bechlal? Why, he eats the cow? Hashem doesn't eat. He needs your wheat, he needs anything. No, anyone has an answer?
To see how you're going to react.
Okay. Okay, there you go. Chazak u baruch kivanta. Both of you in the right direction. The point is to show a few things. One, to show if you know where you're getting your panasa from. Are you making it or Hashem giving it to you? Which one is it? If you're making it, then you're not going to give him the best. Because you feel like if you're making it, if you work so hard, you're not going to give the best of the best to Hashem because you feel like it's yours. It's yours. Why do I want to give the best of what I have to anyone? I made it. I did it. It's mine. This is common language today. I. Every sentence starts with I. It is. I made the money. It's my money. Anytime that the word yours is involved is usually a not before it. Not yours, mine. That's what it is. So, if you think you made it, you're not going to want to give the best thing to Hashem. If you realize that Hashem gave it to you, and in reality, He gave you 100%, 100, not 99, 100. You contributed nothing. Not 99. Some people think, no. Hashem helped me, but I did the ishtadlut. I did the best that I could. But Hashem helped me. No, it's completely false. You contributed nothing. How can I prove this? Very simple. So let's say you say, listen, I wake up in the morning and I go work. I don't know, let's say you work on Wall Street, you work at a building, you work as a cop, whatever you work. You say, wait a minute. I did the research. I woke up in the morning. I went to the office at 6:30 in the morning. So I woke up early. I got in the car. I drove really fast. I got to the office. I drove the car. I opened a different report and I started reading it. I studied. I analyzed everything and I chose which stock to buy. And then I bought it. And then it went up. And I sold it and I won. So in essence, it looks like I did everything. You're missing one small thing though. Who gave you the eyes that you have to see and open in the morning and see the report and drive? Who gave you the brain that has more wiring in it than all of the computers and all of the internet, IT there is in the world in one brain? Who gave you that brain? You made it? You made that too? With the stock market? Who gave you the legs that pressed on the gas pedal? Who gave you the money to pay for the gas you have? Who gave you the ability to even function, Bechlal? Who gave you the soul that turns this piece of meat you call body into a human being. If you say, no, I see, what do you mean I see? No, you don't see. You don't see. Your soul sees. Your body doesn't see anything. How do we know? Just look at somebody that died. They also have eyes, but they can't see. They also have a brain, but they can't think. They also have a heart, but it doesn't work. What makes all of it work? The soul that Hashem gave you. So you contributed nothing, my friend. All you did was make it look realistic. That's it. Hashem is moving the parts. And he's allowing you to feel like you're contributing to the world, so you have some confidence to do your actual real job in the world. Once you realize that he's the one that's giving you the ability to make all this money, then you realize that really, he gave you 100%, 100%, and all you're doing here is giving back 10% to the places that he told you to give. Torah, Gmilut Chasadim, Zikui Arabim, things that are related to the Torah. Help the poor, help the destitute, help the converts. There's different things that you can do with your money. And we've talked about investing your tzedakah money, your maaseh money, you know, wisely, because there are plenty of people that donate to the Red Cross and to saving some rare breed of dog or tiger. Hashem did not give you money to donate to those causes, especially since 99 cents out of every dollar goes to the actual CEO and his friends and not to the actual cause. The little kid in the middle of Africa that's they're putting on the commercial that's waiting for food, it's still the same kid from 30 years ago, if nobody noticed. He grew up by now. He's not still waiting for your food. You know, he grew up. I'm sure he has a job now. Baruch Hashem, he probably is the CEO of one of the divisions of that company. They made so much money because of the poor kid. So, your job is to promote Torah. Whether you're Jew and Gentile, you have to promote Torah. You have to promote Hashem. You work for Hashem. So, I think the most important thing that in today's world, I think it's pretty obvious, is to get people back to Hashem. Because the vast majority of the world is either not following the Torah or is just completely off to idol worship. So the key is to get everybody back to where they need to be. So that's the first part that Hashem is telling you. When you give me, make sure you give me the best, because that will give me the sign that you understand where you're getting it from. Sign where you're getting it from. After that, he tells you at the end of this particular section in verse 11, chapter 26, verse 11. V'samachta b'chol ha'tov asher natan lecha Adonai Elohecha ulevetecha ata ve'alevi ve'ager asher b'kirbecha. You shall rejoice with all the goodness that Hashem your God has given you and your household, you and the Levite and the proselyte who is in your midst. It says, not only do I expect you to give this maaseh, but I expect you to be happy about it. I expect you to make a celebration when you do it. Baruch Hashem, I'm giving 10% of my income. Baruch Hashem. Number one, it's celebrating that you have bichlal income. A lot of people in the world struggle. They don't have income. And for anyone that wants to know where they stand internationally as far as income is concerned, you know, I did a little bit of analysis back when I was in Wall Street days, at least when I was working in it. The last time we looked at it, anyone that makes over $300,000 a year is one of the top 1% earners in the entire world. 7.5 billion people. $300,000. A lot of people think that you need to make millions and millions of dollars to be part of the 1%, or as they call it. But what most people don't realize is that the vast majority of the world does not make very much money. The few people you see on television that are the movers and shakers, the guys that are on the Forbes 500. It's very, very rare to not only be on that list, but to be even a millionaire b'chlal. So it is not, is a lot more today than there ever was before. But nonetheless, if you're making a high income, you're making a few hundred thousand dollars a year, you're considered one of the top 1% earners in the entire world. So Hashem is telling you that if I gave you income, if I gave you $50,000 a year or $300,000 a year or $1 million a year, whatever I gave you, giving 10% is not only something that I want you to do to show recognition that I gave you 100% of the money, but on top of it, I want you to be happy about it. So you ask yourself, what am I going to be happy about? Well, obviously, the obvious answer is number one, that you even have it. But two, is that you're fulfilling one of the mitzvot in the Torah where Hashem says this is the only thing you're allowed to test me on. You're not allowed to say, listen, Hashem, give me a sign or else I'm not keeping Shabbat. Give me a sign or else I'm not going to tell my wife to go to the mikveh. Give me a sign, I'm going to wear a miniskirt. No such thing. You're not allowed to do that. It's considered 100% kfira. But Hashem tells you there's one thing you are allowed to ask for, and there's one thing you're allowed to test me, and I'm telling you to test me. Ma'aseh avetit Hashem. Give 10% of your income, and I guarantee that you will be rich in your lifetime. Now, he doesn't say when. He doesn't say if it's going to happen next month, or next year, or in 20 years from now. He doesn't say when. But he says, in your lifetime, you will be rich. Now, anyone that's thinking to themselves the crazy thought, oh, maybe I'm going to be rich a day before I die, you have a different God than I do then. You have an evil God. My God is good. My God says that I'm going to be rich in my lifetime. That means that I'm going to be able to enjoy this material in some way or another. I'm not going to be just before I die. I'm going to win the lotto and then croak. That's not the God of Israel. So, Hashem says that you're fulfilling a mitzvah, you pretty much have a guaranteed lotto ticket. A guaranteed lotto ticket. Now, Maaser, we've talked about it a few times in the past, but I want to clarify some things, and I promised a dear friend of mine that I would do a shiur about, and I have never gotten a chance, so might as well talk about it now, very, very briefly, because I really want to get into the part of the parashah that I think we need to hear even more. Maaser, in general, most people, what they give is part of the net income. Net income, meaning you have, let's say, $1,000 in income per month, and then you have, $700 in expenses, then you have $300 net income, you give $30, 10% of $300. That's what most people do. What you're really supposed to do, and I verified this recently with my Rav, and this is what Rav Avadia says, is that it's actually supposed to give 10% of the gross. Meaning you made $1,000, you give $100 right off the top. After, obviously, you pay the cost of making that money. Meaning, if the $1,000, you have to pay taxes on it, then obviously you can't give the $1,000. You don't really have $1,000. If your salary, your job is $1,000 a week, but by the time you got the check, they took out taxes, you only have $500, then $500 is the real money. So whatever you got as a payment, you pay 10% off of that money. And even though it doesn't seem like things are going to work because you have your income and you have your expenses and somehow they never add up, you start paying ma'asel and somehow it does. Don't ask me how it does. I've been doing it for a little while and it works perfectly. Hashem makes it work. So that's actually one of the miracles you can see live. The reason Rabbi Avadia says the reason why it has to be off of the gross amount is because it's a, if it was off of the net amount, most people wouldn't even give ma'aser. We would just cancel the whole ma'aser mitzvah because most people are living above their means. So no one has a net income. They're all in debt and in deficit every month. So no one would give ma'aser. But this is not halacha today. If you're in, you're in farming and you live in Israel, there's a different situation. But if you're just a working person, you don't have to give ma'aser. It's considered a madriga. It's considered a higher level. If you want to be rich, you give ma'aser. You don't want to be rich, then continue going to work and keep all the money. But it's Rav Ovadia says that it's a madriga, it's a higher level to give 10% of your gross income. And if you're a real serious emunah, you give 20%. That's the highest level you're allowed to give. Judaism is the only religion in the world and in history that actually has a law on the maximum you're allowed to give. You're not allowed to give more than 20%.
If you're a tzaddik, if you have sins on you, you're allowed to give more than 20%.
If you have a ton of money, you're not allowed to put yourself in a in poverty.
Because there was one big rabbi who gave 20%, he lost everything.
Right, they told him.
And they told him, because you gave more than 20%, you lost everything.
Right, not allowed to give more than 20%.
But someone, because he didn't have one sin on his back.
Still, you went against halacha, against the law. You're not allowed to give more than what Chazal says. You went against the tzaddikim. This is an Igmar, your story.
But we have sins, so it cleans the sins the more we give.
You're still not allowed to give more than 20%. Still not allowed. Chazal says 20% cap. Still not allowed. Not allowed to give more than 20% because you're not allowed to put yourself in financial hardship. But if you do want to give more, it depends on your financial situation. If you are making barely enough to survive, and obviously this applies to you. But if you're a multimillionaire, if you're one of these Forbes 500 people, if you're one of these very high income earners, but you're a relatively frugal person, you make a few hundred thousand dollars a year, but you live a regular normal lifestyle, I don't know, that in America maybe costs $40,000-$50,000, then obviously you have a lot of extra. Instead of building your IRA and your 401k, you can give more tzedakah, of course. If you're making millions of dollars, then of course you can give more tzedakah. But that's tzedakah, it's not ma'asel. Nonetheless, it's a... let's first get to 10%. Let's get Am Yisrael and everybody else to get up to 10%, and then we can talk about 20%. Point is that the halacha is... it's not an halacha to... it's not an obligation to do it, but obviously it's very good to do it. But if you're going to do it, do it with it right. Do it right and do it with a smile. Don't be one of these people that gives the 10% and looks at it like it's an expense, like, ugh, I can't believe I have to give this 10% again. Like, if you're doing it like that, don't do it at all. Keep the money. Nobody needs your tzedakah. It's not going to go to the right place. Instead of you giving tzedakah, you give it to a rabbi, it's going to be the one guy that pretends to be a rabbi, and instead of giving your money to help people do tshuva or help people, you know, have food for Shabbat, it's going to be the one guy that's a criminal that just has a beard. He's going to go gamble in a casino with your money. So you have to, if you're already going to do it, follow what it says. Do it with a smile. Go ahead, you had a question.
So if you have, if you're going to give 10% and you know that you're living right at your means, then you still have to give it?
You don't have to give it. It's up to you. It's based on your emunah. You give as much as you believe.
But if you believe.
If you believe, then you give.
If you don't have it, you know you don't have it after you crunched your numbers. Is it wrong then, still?
No, I mean, listen, it's a, like I said, if you have emunah in Hashem, then the numbers don't have to necessarily make sense. Somehow Hashem makes it work. But again, that's if you really believe. If you really believe, you don't look at the numbers. Because they're never going to make sense. Ever. I mean, I could tell you from my own personal lifestyle, just that, I don't know, my own life is the best example that I know of because I lived it, so... I don't know everyone else's financial situation. But I remember that, you know, when I was in the business world, and you know, on an average month at the peak of my career, we were making somewhere in the neighborhood of, you know, $200,000-$300,000 a month, sometimes more, sometimes less, but overall it was an average of a couple hundred thousand dollars a month. That would be what would go to my pocket. Somehow, I was always struggling. Somehow, always. Like, every month was make or break. Every month was pressure. Every month there was, like, an enormous amount of expenses that were more than the previous month. Every month there was a surprise. And I donated money. I didn't give 10%, but I donated money. But every month was a problem.
Yeah, no beracha.
Exactly. Now, I don't work on Wall Street. I don't work for anyone other than Hashem. I don't even look at my bank account, but somehow... it all adds up, and somehow we have everything that we need. So, again, it's amazing to me that that's how it works, but the best example that I have is from my own life, from my own Rav, Rabbi Ephraim. I keep telling you guys about him. Him and every Avrich practically every avrech is living month to month with no idea of where their income is going to come in, because the kollel gives them $500 a month for studying 5-6 days a week, you know, 9, 10, 12 hours a day. They don't have times for any jobs, for second jobs, third job, nothing. They study all day. There is no other job pretty much for most of them. And they get $500 a month, but the average family, to survive, is going to cost them $2,000, $2,500 a month. Which means that every single one of them is living a miracle. They're in a deficit of $2,000 to $2,500 per month. You know, 5, 6, 7, 8 kids, Baruch Hashem, cost money. They don't, like, just because they learn Torah doesn't mean that the government subsidizes anything. If anything, the government makes their life even more difficult. It used to help them. In the old days, you know, a few years ago, they used to give them some money. Now they, in some cases, they even fine them for not working. It's anti-Torah.
Yeah, Lapidi does it.
So, point is that, you know, they every month they have a miracle. How? You ask any avrech, go to any avrech, how are you surviving? You make, how much you make from the kollel? $500. How much is your expenses? $2,500. Okay, so where does the $2,000 come from? I don't know. But it's every month. It's not one time, two times. Every single month, like clockwork. No one knows how they're surviving. Baruch Hashem. Hashem runs the world. Doesn't have to make sense to us. So again, you have to give as much as your emunah is. But again, your real emunah. You can't just go from nothing to everything. You can't say, listen, I want to test my own emunah. I'm going to give every dollar that I have to do. No, you can't put yourself in jeopardy. You have to really believe it, and you have to grow gradually, like a, you know, like with. Don't put yourself in a situation where if things don't work out right away, you're homeless. You're not allowed to put yourself at risk. You're not allowed to put yourself in a situation where you're harming yourself. You have to comply with the Torah to live. To live, meaning to, you have to protect yourself. But at the same token, obviously, you have to constantly test your emunah, just like you test your muscles. If you're trying to become a you know, muscular person, you have to constantly pick up more weight in order to grow your muscles. So, moving on, after this, Moshe Rabbeinu is telling us our job in the world is to liyot lo le'am zgula kasher diber lach v'lishmor kol mitzvotav. You have to be a special nation, a distinguished people that is going to observe all of the mitzvot that Hashem commanded us. And if you do that, it starts to give us some blessings. V'litchai elyon al kol ha-goyim asher asa le-te'ila u-le-shem u-le-tiferet v'ilotecha am kadosh la-adonai Elohecha ka-asher diber. And Hashem would make you supreme over all the nations that He made, for praise, for renown, for splendor, and that you will be a holy people to Hashem your God as He spoke. So here Hashem tells you, if you just keep my mitzvot, they're not far away from you, they're not so difficult, keep my mitzvot, you have nothing to worry about. You are going to be the number one nation in the world. And now Moshe Rabbeinu tells Am Yisrael, there are a few things that we need to do now because these are my last days. And we have to, first and foremost, make sure that we are a light to the nations. We publicize the Torah. So we have to take on tablets, these stone tablets, Avanim Gdolot. And we have to write the Torah on each one of them in clear language, in a well-clarified language. This is in chapter 27, verse 7 and 8. You shall inscribe on the stones all the words of this Torah well-clarified. So Chazal says, what does it mean well-clarified? Ba'er etev. What does it mean? It means you have to write it in all 70 languages. It must be clear. Why? Because you want to make sure that one day when the goyim find this Torah, each one of them can read it. There's no doubt of whether the Torah is divine or not. There's no doubt that it's the only divine document. There's no other thing that's divine or from God other than the Torah, whether it's called New Testament or Quran or The Secret or Harry Potter or whatever other books people come up with. Nothing is divine. The only divine document that exists is the Torah. But then it says something that is very, very relevant to a lot of Jews, and many of them are religious, actually, today, that most people are not going to really like to hear, but it's a reality check. Vayedaber Moshe v'hakohanim ha-leviim el kol Yisrael le'emor asket ushma Yisrael hayom hazeh niyeta le'am la'adonai el'elohecha. Moses is telling us here in verse 9, Moses and the Kohanim, the Levites, spoke to all Israel, saying, be attentive and hear, O Israel. This day you have become a people to Hashem your God. So he's telling us, asket ushma, be attentive and hear. Asket means be quiet. Do you ever meet one of these people, you're trying to tell them something, but they won't let you talk? Like they say, oh, yeah, I know. Yeah, but what? I know. I didn't even say anything. How do you know? You're trying to, you know, give the guy advice, trying to give him a compliment, you're trying to give him any idea, anything. No, I know. I had a student one time like that, where like before I started saying anything, I said, yeah, I know. So why'd you come? Teach the class. If you know everything, why'd you come, Bechlal? I know. So, if you really want to do the will of Hashem, first, start with being quiet. Listen. Listen to the word of Hashem. Stop talking for a second. Second, is listen, but not just listen with your ears. Listen with an intention to do. Because today, you became a nation. So at this point, we don't have the country of Israel. We don't have the land yet. We're outside of Israel. But Moshe Rabbeinu is telling us that God made us a nation now. Under what condition? Under the condition that we comply with the Torah. That's what makes us a nation. It's not if you support the IDF, you are a nation. It's not if you live in Israel, you are a nation. It's not if you're a Zionist, you're a nation. It's not if you support some Bet Knesset and buy a Sefer Torah, you're a nation. No, none of those. It's not if you kiss the mezuzah 6,000 times a day, you're a nation. What makes you a nation is complying with the Torah. What makes you a Jew is complying with the Torah. As we've said many times, before Mount Sinai, we were all Israelites. We were not Jews. Judaism was created in Mount Sinai. First Jew was the first one that accepted the Torah. His name was Moses. He's the first one that had it. 40 days and 40 nights. Learned the Torah, accepted the Torah, and then had to teach it to the rest of Am Yisrael. Am Yisrael became Jews when they accepted the Torah. Which means that, chas v'shalom, if they would have rejected the Torah, and someone else came along and accepted the Torah, the Israelites would remain Israelites, and the other nation would become Jews. Meaning that what makes a person Jewish is not their mother, or their father, or their neighbor, or who they know, or what books they read. What makes somebody Jewish is what they follow. They follow the Torah, they're Jewish. Now, obviously there's a procedure that needs to follow. If someone is Jewish, then it makes it easier. That procedure is easier for them because they're already born with all of the qualifications to start being Jewish the day they're born. The day they're born, they have to comply with the Torah. They're already chosen to be Jewish. They're already lucky enough that they don't have to convert. But if somebody wants to join a Jewish people, they weren't fortunate enough to be born into a Jewish mother, then they actually, Hashem says, you have the ability to be even more fortunate. How so? If you actually choose Judaism, and you choose to convert, and you choose to follow the Torah, I will consider you even higher than a natural-born Jew. Because the natural-born Jew didn't choose to be Jewish. He was just born that way. So this is how we know that Judaism is not like most people think. If my mom is Jewish, I'm Jewish. Yes, it qualifies you to be Jewish. Qualifies you, and you're technically, you're obligated to be Jewish. But if you don't follow the Torah, according to Halacha, you're not considered Jewish. You don't keep Shabbat, according to Halacha, you're considered an idol worshiper. And this is not just in Shulchan Aruch, this is also in the Gemara. I believe in the Gemara, Masechet Avodah Zarah, page 65. It talks about the issue of Eruv, making an Eruv. You know, you live in a community and you want to carry things on Shabbat. I think it's, 65. I believe it's 65 or 64. Masechet Avodah Zarah. And it says, if you want to carry something in a on Shabbat, you have to make sure that you're not allowed to carry on Shabbat. But if you live in an Eruv, it's considered in essence a one location where you're allowed to do this. But if one of the people that's in this Eruv, let's say, for example, it's between three houses. They don't have an Eruv like Boca Raton, where it's miles long. They had a small little Eruv between, let's say, three houses. They want it to be able to carry from one house to the second house to the third house. So that Eruv between the three houses. But if one of the three houses is a Mechalel Shabbat, can't count on him for the Eruv. Not reliable. Why? Gemara says he's considered the same thing like a goy. He's considered the same thing like as if he was a non-Jew. Can't count him for Eruv. For Eruv! I'm not talking about for being a chazan. I'm not talking about for Eruv, you're not even allowed to count him for. Can't rely on him for anything. For Eruv. This is a chidush. So, someone that wants to be Jewish has to follow the Torah. It's very simple. So now, what happens if someone is doing things that are against the Torah, but he's doing it in hiding? He looks religious. He has the uniform, he has the beard, he has the hat. But in reality, he's one of these psychopaths that likes to look at little kids. In reality, he's one of these psychopaths like this so-called fake rabbi that was looking at women in the mikveh that we heard about. All these crazy people that you have in the world today. They make sins, but in secret. In secret. They look, you know, they look to the world, they look like tzaddikim, gdolim, all that stuff. But in hiding, reshaim, erushaim, and kamoim. This is something like you wouldn't believe. They're the worst of everything. They're little Hitlers. So there's a special part of this parasha for them. Hashem says, the section here we had to go, Moshe Rabbeinu tells us when you go to the land, you have to go to two different mountains. You have to go to Mount Gerizim and Mount Ebal. Half the tribes are going to be on one mountain, the other giving blessings, the other half is going to give the curses. Of whoever is going to listen to Hashem is going to get the blessings. Whoever doesn't is going to get the curses. And the Kohanim are going to be on the, in between the two mountains on the bottom. And they're going to go through this process where they're going to say what the mitzvah of the sin is. And the nation is going to respond. So they give us what they're going to say here. So here in this particular procedure, it's a what the entire nation is repeating and is specifically talking about who is considered cursed. Now Chazal says, if you notice these approximately 10 verses that talks about the cursed, it's for the most part, it's all sex crimes. It's all sex crimes. Why is it sex crimes? Because these are things that you can do quietly. You can do quietly, no one's going to know. So it says this, everyone is going to say it. I'm sorry, the tribes are going to say it, and the Levites, and then all of the people are going to scream, Amen. Cursed is the person that did this, this, and this, and everyone says, Amen. To show that they agree with this, guy's a shah, and he needs to get the worst possible curse in the Torah, Arul. So I'll give you some examples. Arul ha'ish asher ya'aseh pesel u'masecha, to'avat Adonai ma'aseh yedei charash, v'sam baseter, v'anu kol ha'am, v'amru, Amen. Cursed is the man who will make a graven or a molten image, meaning idol worship, an abomination of Hashem, a craftsman handiwork, and then place it in secret. And the entire people shall speak up and say, Amen. He's cursed. Where is he cursed from? For me? No, he's cursed from Hashem. Doesn't get any worse than that. Because idol worship, you could do in secret. You don't have to tell the whole world you're an idol worshiper. Arur makle avi ve'imo ve'amar kol ha'am, Amen. Cursed is the one who degrades his father or mother, and the entire people shall say Amen. Arur masig gvul re'ehu ve'amar kol ha'am, Amen. Cursed is the one who moves the boundary of his fellow. Meaning he's stealing from his fellow. Stealing land, doing things that are illegal, but his friend is not going to notice. Says that person's cursed. Everyone says Amen, and I'll only repeat another two because I think you guys get the point. Cursed is the man who causes a blind person to go astray on the road, and the entire people shall say Amen. What does it mean, cause a blind person to go astray? Chazal says not just about telling a blind person to go right when it's really left. So come on, we have to be more mitbonanim b'milim. We have to investigate the words here. No. Cursed is a person that causes another person to sin. Temei, why don't you come with us to the beach? No, I don't think you're allowed to go to the beach on Shabbat. I don't think you're allowed to go to the beach at all. Nah, you're a new Baal Tshuva. No, it's okay. Don't worry about it. I'll take the sin on me. You're like one of these good friends that people have. Good friends. No, don't worry about it. I'll talk to God for you. The guy's brand new. Doesn't know mitzvah. Doesn't know avirah. Doesn't know if he's Haman. Doesn't know if he's Mordechai. Doesn't know miskin. Eat. It's kosher? Yeah, it's kosher. The guy just bought it from McDonald's. It's kosher. Don't worry. I blessed it for you. It's one of these people. Machti Arabim. So that's to someone that makes another person sin, miskin. Another one, it says, cursed is a person who perverts judgment of the proselyte, orphan or widow. This is mamash miskinim, a people today. There's a lot of converts. The Gemara Masechet Avodah Zarah, page 4, says, at the end of times, there will be a lot of converts. So as we see today, there's an enormous amount of converts coming our way, coming to Rav Mizrahi, coming to different rabbis, trying to ask for help to convert, to become part of the chosen people, willing to die, willing to mamash, to die just to become a righteous Jew. And sometimes you have Reshaim get in the way, you have wicked people get in the way and make their life very difficult in regards to conversion. Now, of course, you have to make sure that the convert is real and they're not just converting because they have a boyfriend or a girlfriend and they want to make the mother-in-law happy. You know, they have to be converting for Hashem, not for the boyfriend or girlfriend. You have to make sure that they know what they're doing, they know the laws, and most importantly, they're going to comply. And not just converting today, they have the kisulos today, they have the long skirt today, and everything is good today, and tomorrow they're going back to the, you know, to the clubs. Or the guy looks like a tzaddik, grew his beard, could sweep the floor with the beard, and the day after he's going to put a tattoo on. With the name of Hashem on tattoo, because he thinks he's doing mitzvah. So you have to make sure that they're real, so they have to learn. If they learn, and they comply, they make the necessary changes in their life. Move to a Jewish community, learn the halachot of Shabbat, learn the halachot of the Chagim, learn the history of Am Yisrael, learn at least the first couple of books of the five books of Moses with the commentary. You know, go through this list of actually knowing what they're doing. They make the adjustments. Conversion shouldn't take more than it takes for them to learn and to adjust. Meaning, conversion should be based on you. Based on the convert. However fast you make the changes necessary and the lessons you learn the things necessary, that's how long it should take you to convert. If it takes you 6 months to do it, chazak u'baruch, convert. If it takes you 60 years, chazak u'baruch, 60 years from now you can convert. You can't just convert anybody anymore because a lot of fake converts. But the same token, what happens today is that you have a lot of fake converts that made it very difficult for real converts. So the rabbis took it from one end to the other, where some rabbis are making it very difficult. They say, no. Minimum requirement is 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. I have one guy, Misken, Tzaddik. He's been going through conversion for 10 years. 10 years. He learns in Kollel every day. He knows more Torah than probably most of Am Yisrael. His kids don't even know they're not Jewish. That's how long they've already been keeping everything. They don't even know they're not Jewish. They're 8, 9, 10 years old. They don't know they're not Jewish. They've been, not the way he started converting, like he just started learning. He pretty much been keeping everything for a decade. But the Reshaim Erushaim of where he lives, they won't let him convert. Why? Because they're Reshaim. So, people like that, talks about them in Parashah. Someone that perverts the judgment of the converts. Arul. Also talks about someone that's a homosexual is Arul. Someone that sleeps with an animal is that has sex with an animal is Arul. Connecting the beginning of the shiur to where we are right now. Then the last one that we have to really take into account is Arur asher lo yakim et divrei Torah hazot la'asot otam ve'amar kol ha'am amen. Cursed is the one who will not uphold the words of Torah to perform them, and the entire people shall say amen. So Chazal says this is, what do you mean, anyone that doesn't keep the Torah is cursed? No, this is not what it's referring to. It's referring to people that are in a position of power to help people get closer to Hashem, a position to teach Torah, and a position to help people do tshuva, and they don't do it. You know the truth, but you say otherwise. You went to yeshiva your whole life, you have a keilah, you have a bet knesset, everybody pays you good money every month, you have a house, you have kids, you have a car, everything is wonderful, but why do you have all these things? Because you never rebuke anyone. You keep telling everyone that they're tzaddikim. They all drive to shul every Shabbat. No, kvod harav. I get to shul 5:30 in the morning. I'm already in my car on Shabbat. I'm on the way to shul. You don't tell them anything. Miskin, the guy's violating Shabbat to go to shul. He doesn't know. Why? Because the rabbi didn't tell him anything. He thinks he's a tzaddik. Because he wrote a book, maybe.
Is he at fault, the guy who drove on Shabbat in the
He's also at fault. Of course he's at
it's
fault.
It's not as bad as if
you Everyone is at fault. You cannot claim ignorance when you go up to Shemaim. You spent 10 years, 20 years learning for your career, being this high-priced lawyer that charges $1,000 an hour. Why? Because you learned a lot, right? Why, you couldn't spend a month learning you about Shabbat just to... 5 minutes you learn Shabbat, you know you're not allowed to drive. 5 minutes. 5 minutes.
Know they're not supposed to drive,
right? Everyone knows they're not allowed to drive. Everyone knows. No such thing as you don't know. No such thing. No such thing as
But people don't know how severe the sin is.
They don't know exactly. Either they don't know how severe it is, or they just don't believe it. Like the Reform, they just don't believe it. They say, we don't believe in your old Torah. We don't believe it. The conservative, same thing. We don't believe it. We don't hold to this high standard. They call the oral Torah, which is pretty much the foundation of our Torah, it's too high of a standard. We have to adjust. Okay, arul. That's an arul. That's a cursed. So someone that's in a position to teach Torah, to tell people the truth and chooses not to, they have a special curse. But now sometimes you have stupidity between rabbis. Between rabbis. Where you have one rabbi that's doing zikui rabin, trying to benefit the public, get people to do tshuva, get people back to Hashem. He's doing the job that nobody else really wants to do. Let's be real here. Most rabbis do not want to do what I do. Most rabbis do not want to do what Rabbi Mizrahi has been doing for 22 years. Most rabbis don't want to do it. Why? Because this is the hard part of the work that is not as financially beneficial as saying to everyone that they're all tzaddikim, they're all kedoshim, they're all rachmanim, they're all nevonim. You don't see any buildings with my name on them. So, this is not exactly the best part of the business, if you will, number one. Number two, you also have a lot more enemies.
Haters.
A lot more haters, because someone doesn't want to hear the truth, naturally, they're not going to like you. But not only not like you, if you don't like some rabbi that's a kila rabbi, you just don't go to the synagogue. But if you don't like a guy that's constantly doing zikui rabim, you see his shiurim online every 5 minutes, a new shiur, a new clip, a new poster, a new this, what do? It starts eating you up. So what do? You start commenting. I hate this guy. He's this, he's that. You start cursing him out, start insulting him, all types of stuff. Now, if it's happening from somebody that is just a hater of Hashem or a hater of the truth, it's expected. It's expected. But what's happening here? He's not talking about that here. Here he's talking about Arur Asher Lo Yakim Et Divrei HaTorah Hazot. He's talking about cursed is the one that's going to get in the way of Kiruv. The guy that's making comments, nobody cares who he is. Who does everyone care? If a rabbi makes a comment, if a rabbi gets in the way and says, no, this rabbi, he's not welcome in our kila. Why Kvod HaRav? Why is not? Oh, no. His teachings are not, they're not this, they're not that. They're too strong for us. Like I just heard from somebody, they didn't allow CDs in a synagogue because, no, we teach out of love. We don't teach Musar in the synagogue. That's what they said. Another case is a rabbi that unfortunately decided to destroy his own Olam Haba and start commenting online, calling it nonsense, telling people not to listen, all types of things. So this is very, very surprising. And there's plenty, unfortunately. So this is plenty. So I had a chidush today. I learned what Rabbi Fine gave me a chidush. Oh, Hashem is full of chidushim. And it says in the book of Samuel 1, chapter 2, verse 9. Says Ragle Chasidav Yishmor Ureshaim Bechoshecha Idamu Kilo Bekoach Yigvar Aish. Translation: He guards the steps of the devout ones, those that are dedicated to Him. Hashem guards their steps, but the wicked are stilled in the darkness, for not through strength does man prevail. So basic literal pshat, the translation of this is that don't worry about it, doesn't matter who goes against you. If you're devout to Hashem, Hashem will protect your steps. will protect your path, and all the Rashaim that are going against you, he's going to take care of them too. Don't worry about it. And you don't, if you really have emunah in Hashem, all you have to do is follow what Moshe Rabbeinu said to Am Yisrael right before we crossed the Sea of Reeds. Hashem elachem lachem v'atem techarishun. Exodus 14:14. God will fight your wars and you shall remain silent. So he's saying you have nothing, you don't have to even fight. The real war is not through the effort of man. The real war is won by Hashem. 100%. So what's the chidush? He says, Ishmo Reshaim Bachoshech Yidamu. Reshaim Bachoshech Yidamu. Reshaim Bachoshech Yidamu. There's a lot of remazim, little hints in the Torah. Reshaim Bachoshech Yidamu. What's the Rashet Tevot? The first letter. Reshaim means the wicked. In the first letter of Reshaim is Resh. Bachoshech, darkness. Bet. Yidamu, Yud. What is it? Resh, Bet, Yud, Rabbi. The Reshaim sometimes are going to be the rabbi. Sometimes it's going to be a rabbi out of some state in California who you never heard of and you don't know who he is. You don't know who he is, you never heard of him, you never did anything to him. You have no idea why he wouldn't like you even bichlal. But he decides to take it upon himself and start telling people bad things about you. So, the Torah tells us, yes, that can exist unfortunately. And in case he's wondering whether what he was doing is right or wrong, as we say, in every parasha, we always find the secrets of relevant to that week. Here in the parasha, chapter 27, verse 26, just in case you're wondering, that Rebbe cursed, Arul. You don't have to fight any wars, my friend. Hashem will fight the rest. But we try to help people do tshuva, even the rabbi sometimes. Miskenim, what can you do? Sometimes people let the Yetzirah beat them, and it's not their fault. Seder. All we have to do is tell people the truth, and Bezat Hashem, they all do tshuva. Don't ask me for names because it doesn't really make a difference. Everyone needs to do tshuva. So, moving on, Hashem continues to give us all these wonderful blessings. There's even more blessings here than we have in Parashat Bechukotai. You know, the beginning of Parashat Bechukotai, we have 10 verses. From verse 3 to verse 13, Parashat Bechukotai, it's 10 different blessings before Hashem tells us the curses. In Parashat Ki Tavo, in this parasha, it's 14 verses. 14 verses of blessings. So one of the nice things that I thought maybe is that in Bechukotai, Hashem is actually telling us directly what the blessings are and what the curses are. In Parashat Ki Tavo, as in the rest of Sefer Dvarim, the book of Deuteronomy, it's Moses speaking. Moses speaking on behalf of Hashem. So I thought that Moses, Le'avdil, obviously he's not Hashem, but he, after going through everything that he went through with Am Yisrael for 40 years, despite them going against him, causing him so much anguish and suffering, he loved them. And he fought for them day and night. And even the blessings that Hashem gave him, he added a little bit more to it. He added a few more blessings to show him, listen, I love you. And I want to tell you that all these blessings you're going to get from Hashem, give him some more details that we didn't find in Parashat Ki Tavo. He gave us some more details of the blessings. But just like he says, there's more verses in the blessings, there's more verses in the curses. In Parashat Bechukotai, it goes from verse 14 to 43. So 29 verses of curses. Parashat Ki Tavo, it's from verse 15 to 68. 53 verses that discuss the details of the curses. Even though Chazal says there's technically more curses in Bechukotai, and Moshe actually lowered it or made it lesser of a curses, there's more details. So it looks like there's more curses. So why I thought to, this is my opinion, I haven't found a source for this, but I think it's nice to think about it, is that Moshe is telling you, listen, I love you, and that's why I give you so many details about the blessings. But for the same reason, for the fact that I love you, I also give you more details about the punishment too. Because I don't want you to get punished. So I want to scare you to death. I want to scare you to death so you don't sin and you never go and fall into this disaster. Chazaku Baruch. Chazaku Baruch. So, he gives us all the beautiful blessings. He tells us that we'll succeed. We're going to succeed materially. We're going to succeed spiritually. We're going to succeed in every way possible. We're going to have more kids, more money, everything and anything. Mamash, Gan Eden in this world. Gan Eden. Amen. V'ayit rak lemala ve'lo tiye lemata. Ki tishma el mitzvot Adonai Elohecha asher anochi metzavecha hayom lishmor ve'la'asot. Verse 13, it says, Hashem shall place you as the head and not as the tail, and you shall only be above and you shall not be below. If you hearken to the commandments of Hashem, your God, that I command you today to observe and perform, and you do not turn away from any of the words that I command you to stay. So he says, as long as you listen to everything, you're only going to be on top. You're only going to win. Everything will be wonderful. Your enemies that will be afraid of you, even the ones that are brave enough to attack you, they're going to come in one line and they're going to run away in seven. You know, meaning they're going to come in one road and they're going to run away in seven, meaning they're going to be in such hysteria of fear that they're not going to have any order whatsoever. Everyone's going to run for their life. Okay, without worrying about what kind of missile system you have, or if you're going to have help from the United States, or if you're going to have help from some other country, or you're going to get some votes from the United Nations, or if you're going to be allowed to defend yourself, Bichlal, because according to the UN, we're not allowed to defend ourselves anymore. Die. Just die. That's pretty much what they said. Not allowed to defend yourself. There's even videos of terrorists actually launching their missiles to Israel from the UN building. What? From the UN building. Not like next to it, down the block. He's just saying, giving a high five to the UN guy. From the actual UN building.
So the terrorists got VIP from there, huh?
Maybe the UN are the terrorists.
Point being is, this is the world we live in. When you're following what Hashem says, you don't have to worry about the UN. You don't have to worry about anybody. You don't have to fight, Bichlav. Everyone's going to be scared of you. And the ones that are crazy enough not to be scared of you, as soon as they come, they're going to run away. You don't have to worry about anything. You don't have to invest into weapons. You have to invest into anything. Hashem takes care of your business.
Even the diseases.
Everything. Hashem takes care of everything. Everything. Someone came to attack us. Hashem sent locusts. Locusts to them. That's what he did a couple of times already. We won a couple of wars because Hashem sent locusts to the enemy. They went to, you know, trillions of locusts, started eating the eyes of all these people, the Egyptians, and also the other goyim.
What is locust?
It was one of these flying bugs that apparently
stick to you
and eat your eyes.
Oh.
If Hashem wants them to.
You can send snakes.
Snakes, he said, well, he can do whatever he wants. He can just kill. The point is that if you do what Hashem wants, Hashem ilachem lachem, v'atem techarashun. God will fight your wars, and you shall remain silent. When we went, when Yeshua ben Nun went to war, Hashem not only helped with the war that he actually brought, there was a bunch of hail. The Midrash Me'am Lo'e says, when Moshe Rabbeinu prayed to Hashem to stop the hail that was falling on the Egyptians, the hail that was falling on the Egyptians was a combination of ice and lava. It was inside the ice was lava, so it was against nature. But Moses, when Paro, you know, begged him to stop this plague, Moses screamed to Hashem, please stop this plague. Stop the hail. And Hashem instantly stopped the hail on the spot, which means there was a bunch of hail still in space, still in the air. So Hashem took it back and he left it, according to the Midrash, in the atmosphere, in the outer atmosphere. And he says that, the Midrash says, part of it Hashem used to fight the Goyim that Yeshua ben Nun fought. It went on their heads and killed them. And the other part of it is going to fall on the Goyim in Milchemet Gog u'Magog, in the war of Gog u'Magog.
Maybe it's Planet X.
Maybe it's Planet X. No, I don't think it's a lot smaller than Planet X. But the point is that it's a... it's amazing what Hashem can do if he wants, if we do his will. But now, what if we don't do his will? Now, I went over a lot of the details of what happens if we don't do it in the past, but I'll go over a few of them. I also went over it in Tisha B'Av, the Shiul we did in the Shabbaton we did in New York with Torah Anytime and Chazak. We had a Baruch Hashem a few shiurs over there. We went over and comparing how everything that happened during the Chorban Bet HaMikdash, both the first one and the second one, also happened in the Holocaust. Same thing. And all of it is written in these two parashot, Parashat Bechukotai and Parashat Ki Tavo, meaning that all the curses that Hashem said that's going to happen, happened. And these are a few of the highlighted ones.
The one with the woman eater kids. That's one. So it says here, says,
but it will be that if you do not hearken to the voice of Hashem your God to observe, to perform all His commandments and all His decrees that I command you today, then all of these curses will come upon you and overtake you. So what does it mean, v'yisigucha, overtake you? Shem Menachem means that before you have a minute to catch up, after you got one of the curses, there's already another one coming. Already another one coming, not even giving you enough time to breathe. Once the decree from Shemayim comes, Hashem Yirachem, Hashem Yirachem. Now anyone that learned the Shiur Torah, one of them that I said my personal story, we had a shiur, I think it was last year or 2 years ago, we went in this parasha, and I showed you guys verse by verse how every single thing that happened to me in my personal tshuva story before I woke up and saw reality, I went through 7 years of suffering, Baruch Hashem, and every single thing that I went through is written in this parasha. Everything. It's shiur number 45. Very good shiur, Baruch Hashem. Abscesses, hemorrhoids, lost money, embarrassment, friends becoming enemies, everything, infections, everything that is in parasha, this parasha. Literally, not even Torah code, literally. I'm sure you can find Torah code, you probably find my name in here. But Baruch Hashem, Baruch Hashem. It's the best thing that ever happened. So, aside from that, you see that, why do I mention this? Why do I mention the stuff that happened to me? Because when people, you know, read this parasha, sometimes, most of the time, they don't even understand what it says. You know, if you don't read, if you don't learn Torah on a regular basis, and the first time you heard this parasha is you hear it in Bekneset, when the Baal Koreh reads it in Bekneset, and you're like reading along or listening, most people don't really understand Lashon HaKodesh to such an extent where they know what it actually means. They hear the words, they hear the sounds, they get a general understanding of what's happening, but the real details they don't know. And to know the real details, you have to like actually read it, which takes more time than just the guy reading it, like, you know, like he does in Bekneset. Second thing is, most people not only don't understand to such a high extent, they don't understand at all. They don't understand anything in Hebrew, because that's not their first language. So that's another one. Third is, people just don't read it, don't pay attention. They're too busy talking in Bekneset. You know, usually the time that people talk the most in Bekneset, when is it? During the time that the guy is reading Torah. Worst possible time to talk in Bekneset, that's when they talk. Hey, how was your dinner last night? Oh, what'd you guys eat, kugel? Oh, yeah, we had knedelach. Oh, no, we had shakshuka. We had shawarma. We had whatever. Who cares what you had to eat? Go to the restaurant then already. Don't come to the Knesset. What do I care about you? Oh, the worst is if somebody is talking business right behind you. You're trying to pray. You're trying to repent. You're trying to talk to Hashem. The guy's like, so, I'm not sure if this client is going to do that. What do I care about your client right now on Shabbat? Go home. Go somewhere else. Why do I have to hear you talk? Why do I have to suffer because you can't shut your mouth? I came here to pray. I didn't come here to socialize. Go out, socialize. Go outside. Go outside. But by the way, halacha is, so you know, it's very, very important to never embarrass anyone in public. We learned this from Tamar, that said that it's better for her to jump in the fire than to embarrass Judah. We also learn this from David HaMelech. But if someone is making an open sin, is a mechtia rabim, he's talking in Bekneset, you're allowed to embarrass him. And actually, according to Halacha, embarrass him to the point, kick him out of the shul. Kick him out of the shul. No one's going to do this in reality because no one has the guts to do it, including myself. But that's really what the Halacha is. You're allowed to... You're actually supposed to kick him out of the shul for talking in shul.
Someone like Pinchas would do it.
Pinchas would do it right away. Pinchas? I think Pinchas would put a spear through him in the middle of the Knesset. Pinchas.
You're not supposed to pray in a shul like that, that they talk in business on Shabbat.
Yeah, find one of them. They don't.
But they have those many marks that they say stop talking.
Can we have? We give them out. Can. So you got to get people.
You should
listen. Listen, put it this way. To sum it, the whole point up is this. Everyone that goes to shul, everyone that goes to pray, first of all, they really have to realize, even though it's a time that people like to socialize, if you want to socialize, socialize outside. You don't have to socialize inside. Socialize outside already. There's no mitzvah of being inside the Bekneset. It's no mitzvah. So mitzvah is praying. Mitzvah is listening to Shul Torah. If you're not praying and you're not listening to Shul Torah, there's no mitzvah. And it's the opposite. You're making an avirah. You're making a sin. It's better not to come at all. Stay home. Or be outside. Socialize as much as you want. That's number one. Number two, in such a politically correct world, it's unbelievable to me how people that are so politically correct are so wrong about this, because it's the most, you know, wrong thing as far as politics is concerned to talk in a Bekneset, because you're interrupting other people, you're disturbing other people, and the whole concept of political correctness is to not disturb other people, not to offend other people. So I come there to pray, and your discussion, it doesn't matter what it's about, it could be about, even if it's about Torah, even if it's about Torah, you're not allowed to disturb me while I'm praying. I'm in a Bekneset. You want to learn Torah, go somewhere else. There's a time to pray, there's a time to learn. Right. So not allowed to do anything. There's a time to pray, time to learn. You want to go pray? Pray. You want to talk business? Go somewhere else. Want to learn? Go somewhere else.
The Zohar says if you talked on Shabbat in the shul, it's like you didn't keep Shabbat.
Could be. Listen, if Zohar says it, that's what it is. But the point is that it's so wrong that if I'm coming to pray, you're going to pray, and the guy next to you has the audacity to talk freely and it's okay and he feels comfortable, and you have to, what do you have to do? You have one of two options. One of two options. Either you turn around and yell at the guy, but then you know what's going to happen, right? The whole B'Knesset is going to look at you like you're the Rasha, not he's the Rasha. They're going to look at you like, oh, why are you so uptight for? If you're probably too high for us. Go to a more stringent B'Knesset. What are you yelling at people for? It's happening. Okay, there you go. Someone tells somebody to shut up, they look at him as the Rasha.
I told him to talk outside if you want, and everyone said, who is this guy to tell them not to talk in shul?
Right, exactly.
That's what they said.
That's Shayim. So that's option number one. It doesn't work. What's option number two? You have to move. Go to a different seat where there's nobody there. So you try to sit in some corner, far away from people. Go next to a few people that don't talk. That's all you have. That's the only option you have.
Is it the same not to go to shul?
Or go to a different shul. Listen, I have a lot of problems with certain shuls, and I've had to change shuls a couple of times because sometimes you go to shul, and it's just not a kosher shul. There's actually a sipul I heard, a story I heard from this week about the Baba Sali. The Baba Sali didn't go to shul on the Chagim for two or three years. He didn't go to the shul. Why? Because he didn't believe that the chazan they had was kosher. He didn't believe the chazan was kosher. And what does the Gemara say about a chazan that's not kosher? Gemara Masechet Ta'anit, page 16, says if you put a chazan that's not kosher, Gemara says this, there's no one in the world that Hashem hates more than this chazan, because right now, because he's such a rasha and he's the chazan, and the keilah gave him kavod, Hashem has to curse the entire keilah. The entire keilah gets. The entire keilah gets. Chal Shabbat. When the entire keilah is rashayim, oh wah. That place, you're not even allowed to be in the same block as a shul as Mechal Shabbat as a chazan.
Sometimes you let him go up because he wants to go.
As a sometimes, he's not even allowed in the B'Knesset, the guy.
The shah.
What can I do? Listen, that's what I don't understand. Listen, you want to be Mechal Shabbat? It's your life. It's your eternity. Do what you want. But why do you have to be a chazan, though? Okay, you want to drive to shul, you want to do whatever you want, you want to eat pig every Tuesday, do whatever you want, but why do you have to be a chazan? Why do you have to pretend that you're religious when you're not?
It's what's a berry in
my mouth. Right, so that's the thing. So that's why Hashem says in the Gemara that he curses the entire keilah. Why? Because it's not only the chazan's fault. It's not only, he's a rasha already, Hashem hates him, but it's also the keilah's fault. Why? Because they put him up there. If the keilah had a spine, if the keilah had 1 ounce of Yirat Shamayim, they wouldn't put a Mechalel Shabbat as the chazan.
Gotta tell that to the rabbi.
They wouldn't tell him. Tell it to whoever. The point is the keilah gets it because the keilah is responsible, not just the rabbi. Sometimes the rabbi is just a puppet. He's the guy with a beard and a hat and he tells people halachot when they ask him. Otherwise, he doesn't do anything. He's scared that they're gonna, you know, the check's gonna bounce. He's scared. What can he do? What can he do?
There's no choice.
But that's the thing. So you have to make sure that you go to a kosher shul. The shul's not kosher, you're not allowed to go there.
Is it a sin not to go to shul?
No, not a sin not to go
to
shul.
I don't go on Shabbat morning to shul.
Listen, you have to do your ishtadlut and find a kosher shul. To just give up on all shuls when you have 18 shuls on your block, but one of them that you went to is not kosher, no, obviously you're missing out on a very big mitzvah of minyan. But, so you have to, praying with minyan is a completely different level of prayer than playing biyachid, by yourself. So definitely do everything you can to go find a kosher minyan. But if you live in an area where there's only reshaim, according to the Rambam, halacha is you must move, you're not allowed to live there. And if you tell Hashem, listen, I can't find, there's no place that I can move to. Everywhere there's reshaim only. Rambam says, move to the desert, be by yourself. Not allowed to live next to anyone. If everyone's reshaim, don't live next to anyone. You must live in an area where you can have a kosher minyan. Must. Not allowed to live. You can't use the default option of, no, listen, there's no kosher minyan, so I don't go to B'Knesset. No, you have to move to a place, the kosher B'Knesset.
Don't during the week.
You can't just use the default option. No, that's the only thing that was available. No, it's not. Why, you lived there 80 years. That's the only thing that was available. You couldn't move at some point during the 80 years. You had to live there. You could have sold the house, buy something else. You could have, you know, get a moving company from Nissan and he helped you move to the next place. Nissan, you help him move, right? To kosher shul?
No problem.
See? Nissan helped me move. He helps everybody move. Why not? Especially if you're going to the kosher shul, give you a discount too.
If you become Aaron and Fletcher's.
See? So, there's no default option. There's no I'm a victim of bad shuls. Everyone has to take care of themselves. So it continues here and it says all types of horrible, horrible things. I'm not going to go into all of them because number one, it will take about 3 weeks. And number two, you probably won't sleep for about a year. So until next year's parasha. So we'll go into only a few of them to give you a little bit of a taste of Yirat Shamayim.
It says in the written pasuk, disturb things, like scary stuff that you said we're not going to sleep till next year.
Yes, if you think about it, yes. Hashem will send you in your midst attrition, confusion, and worry in your every undertaking that you will do until you are destroyed. This is chapter 28, verse 19. ישלח אדוני בך את המערה, את המהומה ואת המגערת בכל משלח ידיך אשר תעשה עד ישמדך. And then it continues. But focus on this part of the verse, says, I'll send you in your midst attrition. What does attrition mean? המערה. No?
Attrition.
Okay. Attrition means you're constantly going to lose your strength. Not because you're just losing it because you're getting tired, because, you know, you're sleeping, because 11 o'clock at night. Because you're going to get beat up so many times. It's just like the chicken cutlets, the schnitzel you make. You have to beat it up with a hammer for a while. You get nice and soft. That's what's going to happen to you, because Shem Yerachem, someone that's going against the Torah, is going to have pressure. He's going to be under pressure all the time. All the time they can't, you know, the deadline. All the time there's bills that he can't afford. All the time there's collectors. All the time there's lawsuits. All the time there's fights from the wife. There's fights from the husband. All the time there's problems from the kids. All the time there's no place to breathe. All the time he can't sleep at night. The few hours that he does have, he can't sleep. All the time it's unreal how much of a disaster our life is. And it's just constant suffering to suffering to suffering with a break in between of joy of maybe an hour a year. That's real life for most people. Most people's life is comprised of suffering after suffering after suffering, and in between there's a little more suffering, and once in a while there's a break of a little joy. That's most people's day and most people's year. How so? You wake up in the morning at an hour you don't want to wake up. So because you don't see a reason of why you're even alive, bichlal, it's already suffering. You're not excited to wake up. Mm-hmm. Like, I wish I was still sleeping. So you're already suffering first thing in the morning. Instead of saying Modeh Ani, you're saying Hashem, why? Next thing is, you get to work. You work for a job you don't want to work. It's more suffering. More suffering. And on the way, you had traffic. And you think the traffic is bad for you because you have to go to a certain appointment. So you're suffering more on the way, you're suffering once you get there. As soon as you get there, the client calls and the client's complaining. It's like, oh, Hashem is giving me more punishment with this client. So you're suffering with the client. And the check comes, but the check is just short, about $150. And you need the $150, or you wanted the $150. You're suffering about the $150 now for the next 3 months. Even though you don't really need the $150 anymore, but you still remember this client that shorted you $150, you're still suffering about the guy. And then your lunch wasn't good. You didn't enjoy your lunch. Ooh, what? You're going to suffer for a week just for this lunch that wasn't good. The rest of the week, you're not going to enjoy the food because of the one day that the lunch wasn't good. And then you finish lunch finally, and then you have stomach aches. Ooh, wow, you go to the bathroom, miskin, Hashem Yerachem, Hashem Yerachem. Bathroom pains, ooh, what? Oh, what? Well, you know, they say in the Gemara, someone that has stomach problems his whole life doesn't see the entrance of Gehinnom.
Ulcers, though, not regular stomach.
All types of stomach problems. All types of stomach problems. Someone that has stomach problems during their whole life doesn't see Gehinnom. Why? Because mamash Gehinnom in this world. Baruch Hashem, this is good for me. This is good for me. It helps me out.
It's not this.
If you're on that level, God bless you. I'm not on that level. I don't pray for pain. I bless Hashem when I have pain, Baruch Hashem. We worked hard to get to that point, but to pray for more, no. That's Rabbi Eliezer. Nachum ish gamzu pray to suffer. Rabbi Elazar ben Rabbi Shimon pray to suffer. Rabbi Yehuda, Anasi prayed for suffering. But if you're on that level, God bless you. Yeah,
Rabbi Yehuda Anasi was a billionaire.
He's a billionaire, but he's at the end of his life, he said, he confessed that he didn't enjoy one penny of it. He suffered for many years. I think it was a total of 29 years. He had 16 years of horrific stomach pains to such an extent that he would tell the guy that was managing his horses, he had a lot of horses, to make sure to feed them at this specific hour because that's when he went to the bathroom. Because when he would go to the bathroom, it was such suffering, he would scream so loud, he didn't want to make the people, you know, sorry for him. So he made sure to, he told the guy, feed the horses. Why feed the horses? Because when horses eat, they make sound. So you feed 500, 1,000, 2,000 horses, it's a lot of noise. But the Gemara says that his screams from the bathroom were louder from all the horses. That's how much he suffered. 16 years. So finally, you got a chidush. Finally, hey, what can I do? I'm working all day. 2 hours I'm working to give me a chidush. What can I do? I don't know that much.
He was a tzaddik. He didn't deserve to suffer like this.
Apparently he did deserve, and I'll tell you why in a second. Second suffering is he had tooth pains. Toothaches for 13 years. So why did he deserve suffering? That's the question, right?
Yeah.
Why did he deserve suffering? So one day, Gemara says, he saw one of the, he was in a slaughterhouse. He saw sheep. And the sheep was scared. So he came and he hid under the gown that Rabbi Yehuda Anasi was wearing. Mm-hmm. It was a president. He wore fancy clothes. He had a gown type of thing. I don't know what it's called. Glima. How do you say glima in gown? Gown, right? I don't think it's called a cape. It's a gown, right? It's a gown. So he had a gown. So this little sheep was hiding under his glima. He didn't want to go get slaughtered. So Rebbe says, what are you hiding for? This was what you were created for. You're only created to get slaughtered, so we say bracha on you and eat you. You weren't created to for us to teach you daf yomi. Right? So he said, you were created to be slaughtered. So he said, that's all he said. To you, you say it. It's not a sin. To me, I say it. It's not a sin. Barely Jews, let alone. It really is what he created for. It's telling the truth. Hashem got upset. Somebody at your level, you don't have mercy. Yes, that's what he was created for. Yes, that's what he was created for, but that's still no mercy. There's still no mercy. No mercy for a sheep. No mercy for a sheep. It's a sin for you. So Rebbe suffered for years. Just for that. When did it stop? When was he able to finally understand why he was suffering, Bichlal? When did the pain stop? One day, he sees his cleaning lady, you know, sweeping the floor. And, you know, in those days, it wasn't exactly like today's world where it was Taj Mahal. You know, those days, there was animals, there was this, there was that. Even though there was fancy places, it's not like fancy like today, so you can't compare it. So there was a rat. There was a rat running around. And the cleaning lady took the broom and sweeped the rat away. Shoot him away, you know, sweep the rabbit away. Like, hit him. Shoot him away. And Rebbe said, no, don't hit him. It's not his fault. This way he's just a rat. He's trying to survive. Don't kill him. the opposite of what he did with the sheep over a decade before. That's when the pain stopped. Why? He showed mercy even to a rat. Yes, it's true that the sheep was created to be slaughtered. But it doesn't mean that we have to turn into machines and have no mercy. It's actually, if you guys didn't hear last night's chidush, we had a nice chidush last night about last week's parasha, about the shluach haken, where Hashem commands us to, anytime you're walking and you see a bird in a nest, and she has eggs or little young birds in there, you shoo the mother bird away, and then you take the eggs or the young. But you have to make sure you shoo her away. Why shoo her away? So you don't kill everyone in the same day.
I never understood this since though.
So did you listen to last night's chidush, 2 o'clock in the morning that I sent? Ah, so you missed it. So I'll give you a short version. I'll give you a short version because I don't want to repeat the same thing. It's not fair to anyone that listened to it. So what's this mitzvah? It's mitzvah. So I had a question, actually. And this young boy, cute kid, sent me a question. He goes, Kvod Rav, I never understood this mitzvah. There's a lot of mitzvah in the parasha, he tells me. But I never understood this mitzvah. It doesn't even sound like a mitzvah. It sounds like a tzar baal chaim. It sounds like you're causing suffering to an animal. So what, how is this a mitzvah? Not only is it a mitzvah, but Hashem says in the pasuk that for doing this, you live a long life. What's the other thing that Hashem says you're going to live a long life for?
Respecting your parents.
So this is the same level as respecting your parents, shooing this bird. When the bird comes home, there's no little chicklets, no little eggs, all the young are dead. It's not nice. How could this be such a big mitzvah? So the boy answers me. So here's the chidush. First of all, we have to understand that not every mitzvah needs to make sense to us. This we already learned before this from Parah Aduma. For the red cow. Just because it doesn't make sense to you, does not mean it doesn't make sense. The shortage is with you. Not with Hashem. That's number one. Number two, this is to remind us that despite the beauty of the animal, the beauty of the world, the beauty of mankind, the beauty of everything, remember that you are the reason for creation. Am Yisrael is the reason for creation. If there was no Am Yisrael, there would be no creation. Which, to add to my story from before, or example from before, the hypothetical example of if Am Yisrael came to Mount Sinai and rejected the Torah, I told you they wouldn't be Jews. But that's not necessarily the truth. The Gemara in Masechet Avodah Zarah, and I think Sota also, says when Am Yisrael was going to Mount Sinai, all of the angels were petrified, were scared. Why? Because they knew that if Am Yisrael rejects the Torah, Hashem will destroy the world instantly. Meaning that if Am Yisrael did not accept the Torah, there would be no purpose for the world. No reason to let the birds and the cats and the dogs and the goyim and the mountains and anything. Nothing. No, there's no reason for anything else to exist if Am Yisrael does not accept the Torah.
Even the stars.
Anything. All Hashem says specifically in the Torah, in the Tanakh, He says, I created all of these stars for you. Masechet Brachot, page 32. All of these stars, I did them for you. So now, number two, we have to understand that the bird, as cute as it is, was created for you. Not you were created for it. Created to serve you. Not you were there to create it, to serve it. Even though a lot of us spend a lot of time cleaning after our dogs and look like the dog is the boss, the reality of it is the dog came to this world to serve us. So if there were aliens and they looked at us, they would probably look at the dogs like, oh, that's their master. Look, that's their king. They look at the dogs, that's the king. So that's number two. Number three, the Rambam says, it's to make us sad. To make us sad. Why make us sad? Anyone with a heart will become sad if you just think about what you're doing. You think about this mitzvah, you become sad. Mother bird has these little birds. She worked on, you know, prayed to Hashem or something to get these little chicklets. And now you're taking it all away. Anyone with a heart will start, you know, maybe shed a tear or maybe feel sorry, something.
Usually comes back to look for them.
Right, she comes back, looks for them. Where's my little guys?
No nest.
What happened? No, nothing. So it makes you sad. That's the mitzvah. Why does Hashem want you to be sad? Because he wants you to feel what he feels. When 80% of Am Yisrael does not keep Shabbat. When all of his kids don't say Shema Yisrael. You have over a million kids. Over a million kids in Israel, in Eretz Israel, don't know Shema Yisrael. A million of them don't know Shema Yisrael. Mm-hmm. You have people, Jews, 60, 70, 80 years old, never laid tefillin since their bar mitzvah. I have a friend. His first time he did tefillin was when he was 13 years old. Second time he did tefillin was a 73 years old tefillin that I gave him at my house. Baruch Hashem, we gave him the tefillin. I hope he's still doing it now. Hashem is sad. Hashem is crying for those Jews. Where are my kids? I give them life. I give them eyes. I give them ears. I give them money. I give them wives. I give them husbands. I give them kids. I give them everything they have. But they won't even look up. They won't even look at me. They won't even pray to me. That's how I feel. So when you think about that bird, you get a little feeling of what Hashem feels like. If that doesn't make you cry, then you probably don't have a soul.
Everyone should do that mitzvah, try to do it once in their life.
Yes, but the big part of the mitzvah is that you can't look for it. Meaning, the mitzvah says, if you happen to see it, if you happen to, you know, you're walking and you happen to see a nest with the bird and the eggs or the chicklets in there, then you do the mitzvah. But if you go look, if you go kill them, you eat them.
Eat
the eggs. What? You make an omelet. I don't know. What are you gonna do with the eggs? What do you do with eggs? Why throw in the garbage? Eat the eggs. It's scrambled eggs. Make some nice. What? You don't eat eggs? All of a sudden you became a no egg person. You eat eggs. I eat eggs also. There's chickens in there, by the way. Don't know.
It's not big anymore. It started to become the process.
Huh?
What if it started in the process to become like?
No, if there's blood, you're not allowed to eat the egg. If there's even one drop of blood in the egg, you're not allowed to eat it.
No, I heard because the organic eggs have almost every single one of them has blood.
Now to eat it.
See,
No. When you
have Mary Leal told me this week, you have to just remove it.
Mapitom, Chas Shalom, Mapitom, Mapitom, Mapitom. That's completely wrong. And I don't know who said it. I don't believe it's him or whoever it is. I don't want to know the name. 100% not allowed. There's one drop of blood in the egg. You have to throw it out. It's not kosher. Mapitom. Who said? No way. No. I don't want to hear the name. Don't correct me. I don't want to hear it. No way that an actual rabbi said that you're allowed. You have to remove the blood. Mapitom.
Because they're organic eggs.
Mapitom. It doesn't matter what eggs. Could be no chance in the world. There's one drop of blood in the egg. You throw it out. It goes garbage. Mapitom. Doesn't matter, organic, not organic. It could be from Alaska, from Siberia. It could be from anything. One drop of blood in the egg goes in the garbage. Not allowed. I don't know what. People make their own rules these days. Shem Yachem. So, don't scare me like that. Tell me rabbis say stuff like that. It's rabbis at tzaddikim. So, I don't know.
That's what I've been doing. Now I know I gotta.
No, ask me. Don't go look at Shulchan Aruch. Don't listen to people. Don't even listen to me. Listen to Shulchan Aruch.
You can't see if there's blood.
A bowl egg is a different story. Obviously, we know.
So it has to be in the egg, or it can be.
Once you open the egg,
no,
yolk comes out.
With the bird.
No. Even if it's a young bird, even if it's a little bird, take it.
Keep it as a pet.
There's no 1, 2, 3.
All of them. All the little birds that are in there. You empty out the nest.
The whole nest you remove or just what inside the nest?
What are you going to do with the nest?
I don't know, I'm just asking.
You keep the nest, you sell on eBay, what are you going to do with the nest?
So you just go in and see a nest, oh, there is a nest on the tree?
Can. Yeah, you can't go looking for it. You can't go out there and start looking for birds with the nest and start taking the thing. That's not the mitzvah. The mitzvah is if you happen to see the nest, you run into it, then it's a mitzvah, is to go and get the birds from there after you shoo them out. But you have to make sure that she's not still flying around. She has to go away.
You have to push her away.
Oh.
She has to go away. She can't watch you do this.
That's too much.
That's too much suffering. It's too much suffering. Even the birds, Hashem worries about them. But the point is to remind you to become compassionate. Have some compassion. Be sad because you'll feel the tzar that Hashem feels every day when his children don't pray, don't talk, nothing to him. They don't connect to him at all. They believe that everything came from an accident, or a big bang, or a monkey, or some other stupid process they're going to create at some point. Scientology.
They're going to have like a new invention.
Of course, that's what they've been doing since the beginning. Why not? Why not? Just the easiest answer scientists have that don't want to believe in God, to explain any stupid invention or theory that they have, just give it time. Just give it more time. What do you mean? But nothing can't create something. Yeah, but if it's a long time. So what if it's a long time? It still can't create it. It doesn't matter, a long time. No, but it's a billion years. So what if it's a billion years or 10 billion years or 5 weeks? Huh?
Everything had a beginning. Right.
Exactly. So that's the thing. So it seems like Hashem doesn't really want me to tell you guys about all these curses. So we're cutting close. Already 2 hours. Oh, Hashem. Okay, so... So first thing is, if you have a lot of pressure in your life, already know that it's time to do tshuva. There's something that you're missing. I'm not saying you're rasha. The Torah is not even saying you're rasha, but it's saying that there's different levels of curses. If you feel like that you can never get ahead, Hashem is talking to you. Hashem is talking to you. And he's also telling us that it doesn't matter what happens with the armies that we have or any of those things. What ends up happening is that, just like before, it says that the enemies come to us on one road and when we kick them out, they all run scattered and scared into 7 roads. It's the opposite here. We will go with one road to attack our enemies and then be scattered ourselves, hush v'shalom, into 7. We're going to be in hysteria. Then he starts talking about different types of diseases, bar minan, that people are going to get. I had some of these. Shem will strike you with swelling lesions, fever, burning heat. I had that one. Thirst with the stored, and with blasts and with withering. And they will pursue you until you perish. So what does it mean? It keeps saying until you perish, but it doesn't say you will perish. Meaning, on one end, he's telling you're going to have a lot of suffering. He's not just going to kill you and that's it. He's going to make you suffer, which is slowly but surely going to destroy you. But on another end, he's also telling you that he's going to give you time. Eventually, you're going to wake up. So the suffering is good for you. Suffering is good for you. It's giving you some more time. Hashem is also now talking about verse 25 about embarrassment. Hashem will cause you to be struck down before your enemies. On one road you will go out against him, but on 7 roads you will flee before him. And you will be the cause of terror to all kingdoms of the earth. So first thing he's telling you that not only will you lose in front of your enemies. The worst thing in the world is getting fired in front of your competition, in front of somebody that you don't like. Lose a client in front of your competition. Lose a client to your competition. Mm-hmm. He's telling you, that's one of your curses. You get embarrassed in front of your competition, in front of your enemy. Your wife yelled at you in front of the guy that you hate, your neighbor. Your husband embarrassed you in front of the one woman that you can't stand in the neighborhood. Just know it comes from Parashat Ki Tavo.
Netanya had a bad, evil wife who used to yell at him.
Again, that's it also says someone has a bad wife doesn't see the face of Gehinnom. Someone has a bad wife. But I admit, that's what it says in Gemara.
Should he divorce her or should stay with her so he doesn't go to Gehinnom?
Depends. Depends what he wants to do.
Gehinnom sounds much worse, though.
It's actually a story. A guy came to a big rabbi, I forget the rabbi's name, asking the rabbi to give him, to help him get a get, you know, to make a get for him. He wants to divorce his wife. He says, the rabbi says, okay, why do you want to get a divorce? He goes, listen, Kvod Rav, from the day I met this woman, and for the last 25 years, she's tortured me every single day. Everything I ask her to do, she doesn't do, on purpose. And every day, as soon as I get home, instead of saying hello, instead of saying honey, making food, how you doing, anything, what does she do? She's so upset, she takes one of her shoes and she throws it at me. Every day she throws a shoe at me. Every day. Who wants to like, I've been suffering for 25 years. Shlom Bayit, Shlom Bayit, Shlom Bayit. I watched Shiur of Shlom Bayit, that Shiur of Shlom Bayit. Went to Rabbi for Shlom Bayit. Listen, I talked to her. I did this. She doesn't want to change. Rabbi says, I know your wife. And you're right. She's not going to change. Okay, so just wait for me in the living room. And I'll get you the get. The guy is so happy. He's like, finally, the rabbi's not trying to convince me. Finally, I can get the get. Leave this devil of a woman.
Be free.
And he's sitting in the living room. It's a true story. Sitting in the living room, waiting a few minutes. And you know, it's a long day. He falls asleep. Falls asleep and apparently has the schut from Shamayim that they bring his neshama up and he goes to the Bed Din.
What, about cleaning?
No, he just has a dream and they show him, they bring him to the Bed Din. He goes to the Bed Din of Shamayim and they say, oh, it's time for us to judge you. He's like, no, I died. And he's like, yeah, it's time for us to judge you. Let's see all of your mitzvot and your sins. And start seeing all the mitzvot. Okay. And the guy was keeping Shabbat, keeping Tarat Mishpah, keeping a few things. Good, Baruch Hashem. But then they start seeing the averot, the sins. Ooh. Worked too much, didn't come to Shiur Torah, was working until 9, 10 o'clock at night, thinking that he needs to help Hashem give, you know, make money. You know, Hashem created the world. He spent all of his money on the creation. He doesn't have any money to give people. So people think that they have to work till 9 o'clock at night. They have to help Hashem. They're doing chesed by Hashem to help him because, you know, Hashem doesn't have any money. He ran out of money. Paying for the construction companies, paying for title companies, paying for... Someone has emunah, never in their life are going to work overtime. Never. Not one time. Emunah. Obviously, we have to get to that level. At the very least, we have to understand that we're not allowed to miss a shiur Torah or miss learning Torah for work. Ever. Ever. Unless you're saving a life, of course. Pikuach nefesh. But if it's just to go make money...
According to one Gemara, you're not allowed to stop to pay to save someone.
Yeah, that's Masechet Megillah. Masechet Megillah, page 25.
If you're learning Torah, someone is drowning, you went and saved him, you made a sin. There's one
pshat. It's like a Gemara. It's Gemara, Masechet Megillah. Yeah. It's a Gemara. It's a Gemara. It's Torah. Learning Torah is more significant than Pikuach Nefesh. But if someone is, that person has no other option, someone is drowning, and you're the only option, you have to go save them. You have to stop learning Torah, and you have to go save that person. But if the person has another option, somebody else can go save him, let them save him. Because so, learning Torah is more significant, but nonetheless, you still have to stop to save a life. But anyway, the guy falls asleep, they start showing him all the sins, all the bitul Torah, all the missed minyan, all of the missed opportunities of doing all the things, all the mitzvot and all the sins. And he starts seeing that all of the sins are gathering and gathering and gathering, and the scale is weighing a little heavier on the sin side. We have a problem. He's petrified, he's scared, he's already thinking of the fire that he's going to burn in, because Gehinnom is very much real. And I said, no, don't worry, we have one more thing. Oh, okay, what happened? He goes, bring the shoes. So he started bringing all the shoes that his wife threw at him.
she miraculous wife?
And she put the shoes on the scale, and the scale got to be even. And it said you only need one more shoe to go on the mitzvah side, you go to Gan Eden. And that, he woke up at that moment, and the rabbi was, okay, I have your get ready. No, Kod HaRav, I don't want to get a get. I'm going home. Thank you, Kod HaRav. Ran home. And every time that he got a shoe in his head from his wife from that moment on, Hashem showed him that his suffering is for his benefit.
Should look for a devil when for Shiduch or...
Listen, you want to bring Yisurim to your life? By all means, there's plenty of ways to bring Yisurim to your life.
I want to avoid hell, you know?
Avoid hell by making mitzvot.
You know all the things that we Bitul Torah, like we don't know what's Bitul Torah, because like Bitul Torah is so severe, like the punishment for it has no ending.
Right.
People say swallowing the saliva while you're learning is Bitul Torah. Like,
you know why you're asking for suffering?
Why?
You know why you think you're asking for suffering?
I don't suffer enough.
Because Baruch Hashem, you've never suffered a day in your life.
Baruch
Hashem.
That's why.
And I should never suffer. And you never suffer. So just like in the opening of the third chapter of Sefer Echa, Lamentations, the prophet Jeremiah starts the chapter by saying, I am the one who has seen suffering. Because he saw the Chorban of Beit HaMikdash. He saw the bodies piled up practically as a wall of death. He saw the river from city to city of Jewish blood. He saw a disaster. And he says to the people that remain, I've seen suffering. Why is it? I said, I have experience with suffering. And I can tell you what it's like, so you believe me, because I've experienced, not because I read it in some book. So I'm not Jeremiah or even his foot or even his nail or the nail of his nail that he threw out. But I know a little bit about suffering. You don't want suffering, my friend. You don't want suffering.
The same game, you know, it's 100 times worse.
Either way, regardless of what level it is, you still don't want suffering in this world. The best thing you want is do mitzvot. If Hashem didn't give you suffering, that means you still have a chance to earn your Gan Eden with mitzvot.
Focus on that.
Yeah, why suffering? Why you want to suffer for? I know suffering.
Everyone suffers a little bit.
Yeah, but real suffering, you don't even know what it is.
You pulled out a dollar and you pulled out a five. That's suffering.
Said that, but no, but real suffering. That's not that type of suffering is not getting you to Gan Eden. That kind of suffering, everybody suffers, but that's kaparat evonot.
Like a flat tire got 2 weeks ago.
Right. No, but that's kaparat evonot. I'm talking about real suffering.
And I went to shul when I got it. That's okay. Even more angry.
You know what's okay? I'll give you a small taste of what suffering is. So you see, when he says to you, you're going to get these burning heat. You know what the burning heat is?
Ulcers?
I'll tell you what burning heat is. You guys want to know what burning heat is?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll tell you what burning heat is. Burning heat. Shem Yerachem, may none of you ever know this. And only know it from the shul. Burning heat is feeling like you're on fire. Feeling like you're on fire and that you feel like you have mamash lava instead of blood going through your veins. And mamash, you feel like you're on fire. And it's unbearable, nothing helps, you can't sleep, I know a lot of details about it because of a reason. Yeah. You can't sleep, you can't walk, you can't think, you can't function, you're screaming in pain sometimes if it's that to that level. Even if it's the lowest level of burning heat, it's debilitating.
What's it called in English?
There is a disease that they say is similar to it. I think it's something fibromyalgia. Something like that. There's some type of disease that they say it's similar to it. All I know is burning heat. I had that for a long time. Baruch Hashem, still have a little bit. Here and there, I get the schut to have it. But it's genom. You feel like you're on fire. What does it feel like? If someone got bitten by a snake. Snake bite, the venom goes into the blood veins, you feel like you're on fire.
Jello.
Feel like you're on fire. So that's what it is, but it's, again, sometimes it's just in your arm. So you just go like this constantly.
Like
no, carpal tunnel is Gan Eden next to it. So you go with your arm. What do you do? You start. So what do you do with it? With your arm, you start smashing your arm on the table, or on the wall. Start hitting to create different pain, because the pain of the burning heat is so bad. It's so bad that you rather break your hand than feel it in your hand. Or if it's in your leg, you start punching your leg, or Shem Yachem, do other things that are worse. But then once in a while, you have a nice schut. It's in your entire body. You can't do anything. What do you want? You want to jump off of a building? Imagine about 5-6 years of that. That's going. That's
gano. You're saying some people have it for the whole life, like 10-20 years. I never heard about this. What's the other bigger word? You said it's probably much worse.
Much worse. You have that and a few other things together. So okay. So why do you guys want to know this stuff?
I'm curious. I like to know everything.
One thing that a person can't do is a person can never really, if they're a mentally stable person, they can never give themselves a surgery. Why can't the person give themselves a surgery if they're mentally stable? Because they're inflicting pain on themselves with precision. If you just stab yourself in the leg, it could just be, it's a one action type of thing, even though still you'll have a very hard time to do that. And you'll always, natural reflex, you always like move it or stop it. You have to be really like majnoon to do something like that. But to give yourself a surgery where you're pretty much inflicting pain on yourself is, you have to be a little crazy. So imagine doing that once a month.
I meant not what happened to you, I'm talking about the parasha.
This is what the parasha is telling you.
You can do surgeries on yourself?
This is what this parasha is telling you. This parasha is telling you.
You can do surgeries on yourself.
Yeah, you can have pain, pain.
You can be long in Alcatraz.
So you have that and the burning pain. And the burning pain. And there's more.
I'm sure it gets worse.
Baruch Hashem, what I had was Gan Eden next to this parasha.
Yeah, yeah.
It was Gan Eden. So, okay, now, move on. That's enough torturing you guys. Miskinim, the rest of the people here are not going to fall asleep for a week after they hear this. Miskinim. So, okay. Hashem will strike you with the boils of Egypt. So, that's abscesses. And if that's what, that wasn't enough, and it says with hemorrhoids. That's how it all started. So it all started for me, November 18, 2006. Innocent hemorrhoids. Innocent hemorrhoids that hurt twice a year. Surgery, a hemorrhoidectomy, that's supposed to be a simple elective surgery. The doctor says he does 5-6 of them a day, like a factory. You know, they have shechita, the cows, they chop them up like nobody's business. Doctor is doing 5-6 surgeries, no problem, every day, no big deal. Says, oh, guy's uncomfortable for 2-3 days, then he goes back to his regular life. Okay, so I become one of those guys, and next thing you know, everything changes. 7 years of suffering nonstop.
Even if you wouldn't have done that surgery, Hashem would have sent it some.
Thank you very much for reminding me, yes, but that's how I got it. You're ruining my story. So, and then he tells if the boils is not enough, the hemorrhoids after, and then the wet boils, and then the dry boils. And the best part of this verse 27 is he says, which cannot be cured. That's what he says. Not only are you going to get these hemorrhoids and these boils, the abscesses and the fire and your pain and all of this stuff, it can't be cured. Go to 50 doctors, Mr. Millionaire. They still can't heal you. Why? Ufekol basaru maflia asot is who's giving it to you. Hashem Yitbarach, the creator of the world, is the one that makes you sick or the one that makes you healthy. If you're sick, you're only going to doctors to make it look realistic. But the one that heals you, you want a solution? You go to the same one that gave it to you. Took me a while to realize that. Another part of the sin, he says you're going to marry a woman. Oh, Hashem, this did not happen to me. You marry a woman and she's going to be with another man. You're going to build a house and somebody else is going to live in it. You build a house and Shem Achem lose it. As soon as you build the house, I had a friend actually it happened to. The guy worked his whole life, was a plumber. Worked his whole life, worked really hard, whatever. Built his house, mansion, beautiful house. $3-5 million, whatever. It was, in my opinion, one of the most beautiful house I ever saw. Everything you could possibly imagine, all the amenities, something almost beautiful. And like all the finishing touches and everything. And one day he finds out that his wife is cheating on him with the accountant. And then shortly later, the deal that was pretty much holding him financially with a building goes to nothing. So he loses his wife and he loses his house, loses his money, Hashem Yirachem, and he ends up losing his business. This verse, actually, I'm thinking about it right now. This entire verse, verse 30, actually happened to him. His skin. Pete. He lost all his Hashem. No, he was Greek. It's Greek. Skin. So, yeah, that's what happened to him. He owes me $500,000, so that's why he didn't pay. So, this is what happened to him. That's why he couldn't pay me. He lost, and I don't hold anything against him because, well, this is actually what happened to him. He lost his wife, Miskin. He lost his house, and he lost his business. He had to restart everything from scratch.
Is he doing good now, or is he still
locked down? He's surviving, but he's not, I don't think he's making like money like he used to. But anyway, this verse actually happened to him. This entire verse, one verse. Baruch Hashem, what can you do? So, this is one of the things Hashem says you go against them is what happens. Then it says, your sons and daughters will be given to other people. Now, this can mean a few things. And your eyes will see and pine in vain for them all day long, but your hand will be powerless. Your kids go with your enemies, Chas v'Shalom, as hostages in war, Chas v'Shalom, and in many other things. You could go and become intermarried, go marry goyim. And it says specifically here, your hands are going to be powerless. You're not going to be able to do anything. You tell your daughter, no, don't marry him, don't marry him. She's like, Ima, don't tell me what to do. Abba, mind your business. It's a punishment to the parents, not just the kids. Punishment to the parents. Why? Because the parent did something to deserve this, apparently. It says, a nation unknown to you will devour the fruit of your ground and all your labor, and you will be only cheated and downtrodden all the days. Meaning it doesn't matter what you do. Anyone you hire, all the vendors you hire, all the people you deal with, everyone's going to take advantage of you. Unless this is exactly what happened to me towards my downfall. Hire lawyers, and lawyers take advantage and charge me all the money in the world and do bad things. Hire a company, some type of technology company, they do horrible job and still charge me $60,000-$70,000 for the horrible job. All, like, pretty much everything that could go wrong went wrong. I hire a manager to run an insurance division, I give the guy a $25,000 signing bonus. 9 months later, I find that the guy is not only stealing from me, but he's mamash, like all the money that he's supposed to be making for this division, I don't see it. He's like, no, it's going to take long. It's going to take long. I find out that he's taking it for himself. And on top of that, he's overcharging the company for different things. I hire a different manager to run my brokerage division. The guy's stealing from the office. All types of things. Everything that could go wrong goes wrong. Well, Hashem wants to wake you up. Baruch Hashem, he has a lot of ways. So he says, you will go mad from the sight of your eyes that you will see. Mamash, you start seeing. Everything goes wrong. All of a sudden, the stock investments go bad. The health is terrible. The friends are terrible. The employees are awful. You start losing your mind. No, it's just started here. So Hashem, it gets much worse. Hashem will strike you with a foul boil on the knees and on the legs that cannot be cured. Again, from the sole of your foot to your crown. So that's actually when The pain in the bottom of my feet started, and then a few days later, my legs doubled in size, and then I couldn't walk for about a year and a half. And they just got worse and worse over time. Baruch Hashem. So then, let's skip a few of them. You become a conversation piece. You get to a point where everybody starts talking about you. Oh, remember that guy? You know what happened to him? That's what I became. I became that guy. Remember that guy? He was on CNBC and da-da-da. Yeah, you never know. He lost all of his money. He lost this. He lost that. That's what happened. Used to be famous. Used to be, oh, remember that guy? Yeah, I worked for him. Oh, wow, you worked for your own? Psh. Chazak u'bok. Now it's like, what, you still in business? You say it goes from one opposite to the other one. Mamash, that's how it works. You will bear sons and daughters. Baruch Hashem, this I didn't have. You will bear sons and daughters, but they will not be yours. Namamzeut. It's when you have children with a non-Jew. A Jewish person has children with a non-Jewish woman. Children are not considered his. This is a form of punishment. Form of punishment.
Some people.
Why? Because one day he's going to do tshuva. One day he's going to do tshuva. And he's going to realize, oh, according to Allah, I didn't fulfill the mitzvah of pu'ul bu. I didn't fulfill it. It's a problem. And many other things. So that's why it's better to do tshuva sooner rather than later. Let's go skip a few more. All these curses will come upon you and pursue you and overtake you until you are destroyed. Because you will not have hearkened the voice of Hashem, your God, to observe His commandments and decrees that He commanded you. There will be a sign and a wonder in you and in your offspring forever. Because you did not serve Hashem your God amid gladness and goodness of heart, when everything was abundant. So here he's telling you, not only are you going to get all these curses and everything, but part of the reason why you're getting all these curses is because when everything was good, I gave you money, I gave you health, I gave you wife, I gave you kids, I gave you a job, I gave you everything. What'd you do? You forgot about God. You became CEO of Goldman Sachs, making $50, $100 million a year. All of a sudden, I want to be reformed. Became business owner, started a company, started making a little bit of money, more than just a few thousand dollars a month. All of a sudden, I don't want to keep Shabbat anymore. What happened? You were keeping Shabbat more as a poor guy than a religious guy. He goes, yeah, but now I'm busy. Now I'm busy for God. So, oh, you're busy for God? Okay. We'll see. We'll show you what happens. When things were good, you didn't serve me. That's one reason you're going to get the punishment. What's the second reason? What's the second form of punishment? It's the worst type. He says, because you didn't serve me when everything was abundant, so you will serve your enemies, whom Hashem will send against you in hunger and in thirst and in nakedness and without anything. And He will put an iron yoke on your neck until He destroys you. Hashem irachem, Hashem irachem. Saying you don't want to serve Hashem, you don't want to be religious, you don't want to keep Shabbat, you don't want to keep kosher, you don't want to keep Ta'alat Mishpacha, you don't want to do anything. Fine. Just know, ultimate punishment, instead of serving Hashem, you're going to serve your enemies. And this is what happened in the Holocaust. This is exactly what happened in the Holocaust. Rabbi Cheskel says a story in his book, Bekaf HaKela, about the Holocaust. And he says, the worst part about the Holocaust was the hunger. Hunger, suffering from hunger. They wouldn't feed us for days. People got to a point where they would use the food, the little old slice of bread, as money. Because you were rich if you had a slice of bread. If you had tomato, ooh, what? But he said, the worst, absolute worst punishment we ever got was when the verse from Parashat Ki Tavo and Parashat Bechukotai came true. And we got to a point one day, these Reshaim Erushaim, worked us nonstop, and they didn't feed us at all. It got to such a point where some guys started dying on the job. Dying on the job. Eventually, the few that survived, they stopped us from working. I said, okay, go back to the barracks, go back to the places. And we come back, we see a big pot and a German Nazi. Zevel shel ha'olam, garbage of the world. Evil, rasha merusha. He's cooking in this giant pot. We smell, the first time we smell meat in years. Say, wow. And we all run to get this food, thinking, oh, maybe this Rishayim have a heart. They worked us for the last couple of days straight without drinking, without eating, without anything. And maybe this is their reward. And we all grab whatever meat we can get from the hot water, not caring about anything. Just get whatever you can eat to survive. Until one of the people runs out, one of the Jewish people runs out, no! It's your children. Hashem Yirachem, Hashem Yirachem. Ve'achalte pri bitnecha, besar banecha ubenotecha, asher natan lecha Adonai Elohecha. You will eat the fruit of your womb, the flesh of your sons and daughters, which Hashem your God has given you. This didn't only happen in the Holocaust of eating our children. It also happened in the Beit HaMikdash. It also happened in the Beit HaMikdash. What people don't understand is that when Hashem says something, He's not joking. When He said in the previous verse that you're going to end up working and serving your enemies, this also happened in both the Beit HaMikdash as well as in the Holocaust. We said this in the Shu'im, but for anybody who didn't hear, there's a book called I Was Mengele's Assistant by a Jewish guy named Mikolos Nitzili. You can buy it, it's a famous book. And this Jewish guy tells about his experience working for this Rasha Merusha Mengele, which the Jewish people also called Malach HaMavet, the angel of death. This Rasha Nazi used to be responsible on making all types of experiments on human beings, which is the reason why Germany after the World War II became more advanced in medicine than anyone else in the world, because they did experiments on the Jewish people. And this Jew, Mikolos, was his assistant. And apparently this Mikolos wasn't exactly the biggest tzaddik in the world before the Holocaust. And he got a special punishment because he didn't want to serve Hashem. He ended up serving his enemy. He ended up serving the Nazis, ended up working for them. But if that wasn't bad enough, unfortunately, when you have enough evil, you can become part of it. And he writes in his book that he became passionate working for this Rasha, and he would help him with his collection of body parts. He would go look for gallbladders in different bodies and be excited to give it to his boss to add to his collection, because his psycho boss, the Nazi, instead of collecting baseball cards or football cards or stamps, he collected body parts from Jewish people. Oh, he's already in Gehenom and never going to get out. But the point is that this is showing how Hashem is telling us, is fulfilling these verses. He's not joking. It's not gray area, it's black and white. Black and white. There's no gray area.
Experiments. I heard horrifying stuff that were doing to Jews there.
Yeah, you could literally could read from that book. That book, actually, a lot of the sources of what happened in those experiments are from this guy. Yeah, this guy.
Is there a documentary about it on YouTube?
I don't know about YouTube. I don't know about the documentary on YouTube, but it's possible. So it says here, and also in case anyone is saying, oh, maybe this is a stretch, how can you connect the Nazis to any of this stuff aside from Torah codes and everything else, where you look at no further than verse 49, chapter 28, verse 49. It says, Isa Adonai Alecha Goy Mirachok Mikze Aaretz Kaasher Yid'e Anasher Goy Asher Lo Tishma Leshono. It says, Hashem will carry against you a nation from afar, from the end of the earth, as an eagle will swoop, a nation whose language you will not understand. What was the sign of the Nazis? An eagle. What was the sign of the Romans? An eagle.
Is it
100%. And also, if you look at Torah code, you see the names of Hitler in here, you'll see Mengele in here, you'll see the Eichmann in here, you'll see the concentration camps, city names, all that stuff in this parasha. Go ahead.
Are the punishments for non-Jews too? Because the sign for America, right? The eagle, bald eagle is the national sign, slavery.
Yes and yeah. I mean, yeah, to some extent, yes, of course. I mean, as a Torah applies to everyone, of course the Jews must comply with more laws in the Torah than the non-Jews do, but the punishments for some of the violations that Jews do are lesser than the goyim. Meaning, if, let's say, for example, a Jewish person steals and they get caught, they have to return double. So he stole 100, has to pay 200. But if a non-Jew steals, it's death penalty. So they have less, the non-Jews have less laws. They have less laws, but each law, if they violate it, is death penalty. There's no other punishment. It's 100% assault. So there's less laws, but more, you know, more significant ramifications. So yeah, I mean, obviously, if non-Jews go against Hashem, they also get punished. There's no question that they're also Hashem's creations. They also have to comply by Torah, but it's just the rules that apply to them. Moving on to finalize this, because I think you guys got enough of an idea of what's going on. It says, after we work for our enemy, after Chas V'Shalom, the people get to a point of having to eat their children to such an extent that it says that a delicate woman, a woman that was so delicate that she would be scared to go outside. Scared to go outside. She didn't want to deal with the public. She was modest. But as you know, when there's a decree for the nation, the wicked and the righteous get punished the same. So this delicate, modest woman, Hashem Yarachem, goes out, and he says she completely loses her mind to the point that she starts fighting with the rest of her family of the kids that she's going to eat.
What, over here it says that she's going to also want to eat the kids?
Yes, and she will eat them in secret for lack of anything in the siege and distress that your enemy will distress you in your cities. So it gets bad.
This all happened because the Biryonim burned all the food in the
Bitcoin. It happens because we sinned. And then last but not least, it tells us something awful. It says, and you will be left few in number instead of having been like the stars of heaven in abundance. In the book of On Your Walls, Jerusalem, talks about what the situation was like before the Churban Beit HaMikdash. And we'll finish with this point to give you guys an understanding. This doesn't make sense to us because we think in numbers based on our knowledge of today. So this is not going to make sense to anyone, but it's true. And even if it's exaggerated, it still gives you an idea of how many people we had. It says here, Chazal tells us in Midrash Rabbah, and also Yakut Yeshea, and also in the Gemara Masechet Gittin. Several different sources. Gemara Masechet Gittin, page 57. Chazal gives us the description of Yerushalayim, of Jerusalem. It says in Jerusalem there was 24 main squares, and each square had 24 main thoroughfares. And each thoroughfare had 24 small streets. And each street had 24 smaller pathways. And each one of these smaller pathways had 24 courtyards. and each courtyard had 24 homes. Got it so far? And passing through each of these courtyards every day was double the amount of people that left Egypt, meaning no less than 1.2 million in each one of the courtyards. Passing through it.
So the courtyards have to be bigger than Boca.
We'll get to the numbers in a second. That's why I'm telling you this. If you do the math, this means that there were 18,824 side roads, which means that there was 331,776 smaller passageways, 7.9 million courtyards, and 191,102,976 homes, houses, in Jerusalem alone. Now, according to today's knowledge, this cannot be. It's impossible. It doesn't fit. But Chazal tells us in Eicha Rabba, and also in Gemara Masechet Gittin, that Eretz Yisrael is like a skin of a deer, which stretches. But once with the Jewish people removed from the country, it shrinks. A deer's skin, you could stretch it and stretch it and stretch it with no end. Stretches now, it's unbelievable. It's miraculous how much it stretches. You can make so much out of one small deer. And he says that Eretz Yisrael is the same thing. When Am Yisrael comes in and we're holy, and there's no limit to the amount of people. And it says here, besides there being almost 200 million people actually living in homes in Yerushalayim, the fact that there's 1.2 million people passing through each courtyard means that there was 9.55 trillion people traveling back and forth in Jerusalem every day. Trillion.
Nine five 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 148 800 000.
Yes, what do you think? You guys got it from his head. So I just told you. As a matter of fact, No, trillion. And this is actually no. It's absolute. Nobody says that. Nobody said no. Not according to the Jew.
In the world.
According to science, yeah, but not according to Judaism.
How did they have enough food then to feed?
If you look, actually, if I did the math one time with Rabbi Fine, I'm finishing this point. I did the math one time with Rabbi Fine, and we did the math on how many people left Egypt. How many people left Egypt? Now, there's a midrash in Ma'am Loez says that there was 300 million Jews. In Egypt. 300 million Jews and only 3 million left Egypt. Meaning 297 million, Hashem killed them in the plague of darkness. And there's other midrashim, let's say even more. But we did the math of how many people, the lowest number of people leaving Egypt is 3 million. No one actually really believes there's 3 million only left Egypt. Everyone believes it's a much higher number. But we try to figure out how many there were. So we have to look at it this way. If every family, it says in the Torah, each birth was 6 kids. Each birth. Each time a woman gave birth was 6 kids. Average family, through their marriage, let's say they would give birth 10 times. Not like today where they only wanted 2 kids and a dog. Each family average would have probably 60 kids. By the time you serve them breakfast, it's already dinner. You need a truck to feed all these kids. So you have, at the very least, you have 600,000 men. That means you also have at least 600,000 women between the ages of 20 and 60. But it also means that the amount of kids that you have is drastically higher. Long story short, we did the numbers, the calculations took us a while. We came up with a number very similar to that.
A trillion.
Over a trillion people. did the math, calculations, this. I mean, I know a little bit of math.
Which is different opinions.
It sounds...
Like
right. One Midrash, I just said this. One Midrash only says 3 million. One Midrash says 300 million.
One out of five got killed.
Right. Most common Midrash says 1 out of 5 Jews survived, which means 80% died instead of 99%. Doesn't matter. It still shows, obviously, a horrible number. But some people say only 3 million people left Egypt. Some people say, 30 million, 12 million. There's different numbers. The average is somewhere around like 10, 15 million.
You're saying trillions of people got killed in Chorban Beit HaMikdash.
Yeah. According to the Gemara, according to the sources here in this Midrash, there's a lot of people. Again, even if the trillion, like he said, the author himself says, even if you want to say that the sources are exaggerating, it's not 9.5 trillion. It's still not 9 million. It's still not 9,000. Still not 900,000. You're not going to exaggerate by that extent.
Everyone knows
it's a lot.
10 to 20 million.
It's a lot. You understand what I'm saying? So whatever the number is, Hashem says, used to be like the stars. Used to be like the stars. Because you sinned, you're going to become few. Few in number. We always asked Hashem, where? When were we alive? It was only barely, 15 million Jews in the world? 20 million Jews in the world? How many Jews are in the world? That's what we think. And out of them, how many actually keep mitzvot? I mean, there's very, very few of us in the world. But used to be a lot more. When we kept mitzvot, used to be a lot more. Each birth would be 6 kids.
More than the Goyim were, right?
More than anyone. We were the strongest, we were the most populous, we were the smartest, we were everything. But we forgot about God, and that's what happened. And this is the last line that we'll finish off with today. It says in chapter 28, verse 69, Ele divrei habrit asher tziva Adonai et Moshe lichrot et bnei Yisrael be'eretz Moab milvad habrit asher karat itam b'chorev. These are the words of the covenant that Hashem commanded Moses to seal with the children of Israel in the land of Moab, besides the covenant that he sealed with them in Horev. Horev is Mount Sinai. So he's saying, just, I gave you the Ten Commandments, I gave you the written Torah, the oral Torah and everything, but I want to make sure you guys realize, in case you forgot over the last 40 years, there's also a consequence of if you don't listen to me. There's also a consequence of if you don't listen to me, and this is all the details. And again, right now we're in the month of Elul, there's a reason why this parasha comes during this month, time to do tshuva. It's a time to stop with the Lashon Hara. It's a time to stop messing around with Shabbat. It's a time to start keeping mitzvot and be serious. It's time to be modest and stop dressing like prostitutes. It's time for guys to stop dressing with really tight clothes so we can see the definition of their body. It's time for us to start learning Torah like it's real important to us, instead of torture. It's time to put Torah as number one and work as number something else. It's time to start believing that Hashem is the one that's giving you your parnasah and not your job. Your job is just to make it look realistic. It's time to take things seriously. And if it's not because you have Judgment Day coming up in the next couple of weeks, and you have to stop messing around, because nobody promises you tomorrow. If it's not for that, it's for what we learned today. This is very much real. Baruch Hashem, as I told you guys, I experienced a small part of it. And I wouldn't wish my enemies, I wouldn't wish them what I suffered for one day, let alone for 7 years. So, it's time for us to start doing tshuva. Make it that you got the message from me. Because when you get it from me, it's painless. It bothers you. Maybe you're going to lose a little sleep tonight. Maybe you're going to be a little worried. Maybe the next time before you sin, you're going to think twice. Bezrat Hashem. But it's still painless. If you wait for God to tell you, it's not the same. It's a little more painful. You understand?
Yeah.
So better you listen to me and what I'm reading to you, because it's the same Torah. And Bezat Hashem, we do tshuva. Questions?
Yeah, I heard.
He has good questions. So you make Jews, the tshuva better.
No, you said there's so many Jews living. So I heard that all the money in the world belongs to the Jews. But since, like, the Jews, they waste their seed, they do stuff that they block their shefa. So the money goes to the dark places, like to Las Vegas, to dirty movies.
I haven't heard that midrash. There, I mean, I know that
we would have all the money in the world.
Well, it says here that we would be on top and on top of everybody else.
Yeah, we block it for ourselves.
Yeah, it says in the beginning of the parashah that one of the blessings if we follow Hashem is by being number one, being everyone else serving us in essence. So yeah, I mean, listen, the everyone has a purpose in the world, but the ultimate purpose is belongs to the Jews to fulfill it. But when we don't fulfill it, everyone suffers. Everyone suffers. Next. Scare you guys enough to do tshuva?
Yeah.
Baruch Hashem. Baruch Adonai L'olam. Amen ve'amen.